Let's try this again. Get shut. Okay. Good morning. My name is Mike Pactican. I'll be calling this meeting to order of the Standing Policy Committee on Protection, Community Services and Parks, Friday, November the 27th, 2015. I'm pleased to be joined by my council colleagues, Councillor Russ Wyatt, Councillor Ross Eady, and Councillor Jason Schreier, as well as our committee clerk, Ms. Josie Marks, and several members of our public administration. Madam Clerk, or sorry, I can move the minutes to the last meeting to be taken as read and confirmed. Moved by Councillor Eady. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. We have
two delegations. If we could suspend the rules to hear them.
Looking to suspend the rules to hear two delegations.
I'll move a motion to suspend the rules.
By Councillor Eady. All those in favor?
Aye.
Councillor Sharma is first.
On which report?
Councillor Sharma.
Item two.
Oh, really? Yeah. Well, Councillor Sharma and
Councillor Sharma.
Councillor?
Just make sure you have a microphone.
Morning, welcome. You're here to speak on item number two, the proposed changing of the order of the library replacement within the library redevelopment strategy.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chair and committee members. Congratulations, first of all, to you, Councillor Pactican, on your first meeting as chair of this committee.
Second.
I am pleased to appear today to speak to item number two, the library development strategy. Library services, I think we can all agree it's such an important service that we offer our citizens, Mr. Chair. As a first-generation Canadian whose first language is not English, I remember fondly how much my family relied on the public library system for getting a better command on the English language. I remember visiting the public library on a regular basis with my parents, my siblings, and now proudly carry on that tradition with my husband and my young son. Today, modern public libraries are community hubs. They are destination places for early childhood literacy, for leisure activity, and lifelong learning. I don't believe the current setup in North Winnipeg is adequately serving the needs of the community. North Winnipeg is growing by leaps and bounds, Mr. Chair. Two members of the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee are here on the Parks Protection Committee, Councillor Eady and yourself, Mr. Chair. And you both have seen firsthand the applications that come forward to our community committee regarding development in North Winnipeg, and things have really exploded over the last number of years. And I know that we're going to be continuing in that direction as there's so much vacant land still to be developed. The report before us today, in my opinion, is very self-explanatory. I very much support the recommendation of our public service that the West Kildonan Library planned for replacement be moved up from 2017 to 2021. This option before us, it doesn't impact the city's capital funding requirements financially, as both the Westwood Library and the West Kay Libraries are proposed as lease facilities. So that's a very positive thing. I'm well aware, Mr. Chair, that people often use multiple libraries, partly because of different hours we offer and different collections that may be available in various locations. I also know that the residents in my ward would really like to access library services within close proximity to where they live, and this is currently not available to them. I'd like to put on the record that the Old Kildonan Ward is the only ward in the City of Winnipeg that currently does not have a library within its boundaries. So I don't believe the current setup in North Winnipeg is adequately serving the needs of our community. We need a better location to serve a wider community, and this report addresses this very issue. So today I'm asking for your support to move this recommendation forward. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Sharma. There's a couple of questions. First off is Councillor Wyatt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Councillor Sharma. Thank you for your presentation. My question is, I asked a similar question of Councillor Lukes, who was before, it was actually the Property Development Committee, and it was regarding her proposal for the South, which was now called the South Recreation Complex. And I asked her this question, so I'm going to ask you the same sort of question, and that is this. There's a lot of demand in our city for facilities, new facilities to serve growing areas of the city, new parts of the city. And I call it, and not just myself, but a lot of people call it soft infrastructure. Soft infrastructure being things like libraries, being things like pools, being things like rec facilities. outside of the hard infrastructure of the roads and the, the sewers and the water pipes, would you, in light of the fact that we have this challenge in terms of funding these facilities, and there's a huge demand for recreational and library facilities, leisure facilities in the city is growing because we don't have a plan yet. We do have the library plan, but we don't have an overall recreation plan. Would you support adopting an area charge in your area on new development that would stay in the area, which right now under the charter we have the ability to do, as long as the funds are charged on that area and stay in that area for the benefit of that area? Would you support adopting something like that in your area?
Councillor Wyatt, thanks for the question. I'm not going to comment on that today. I think Council is doing some research, further research around that, and that's a conversation for another day. And I really am sure we'll be having those type of conversations during our budget deliberations.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Councillor Eadie?
Yeah. Just on that, on area charges, do you recall the meeting in which there was a request from our community committee to investigate a Chief Peguis area charge to help fund some of the extension? And we had a report came back. And in that report, if you recall, the Chief Peguis was not eligible for an area charge because Chief Peguis Trail is about trade throughout the whole city. It's part of the inner city road work. And but they did say that there was a court case regarding the Charleswood traffic area levy that Mr. Clement wisely established back in the, I think it was the early 90s, if I recall correctly. It might even be in the late 80s. And in there, our administration already advised us that we won a court case, the challenge, because the area charge was within, at that time, the City of Winnipeg Act, and our charter continues to reflect our ability to do area charge. So do you recall that, Councillor?
I don't recall, Councillor Eadie, off the top of my head, but do you have a question for me regarding the presentation that I'm making today?
I just asked, do you recall it?
No, I don't at this moment.
You don't remember that meeting, huh?
Okay.
You were mentioned that Old Kildonan doesn't have a library. Is Garden City part of West Kildonan?
Sure.
So part of your ward does have library services. It's the West Kildonan Library. Would you agree with that?
The West Kildonan Library is a beloved library. I've used it myself many, many times with my family. It does serve a small catchment, and I think that is outlined in the report. I'm looking to have a modern facility in North Winnipeg, like Charleswood does, so it can better serve Point Douglas, yourself, and the Old Kildonan Ward.
Okay. I just was asking because you were saying you have no library in your ward, but that
it's
library,
a fact. It's a statement of fact.
Since 1967, that library has been serving part of your ward. Right?
Yes, and it actually was in Old Kildonan prior to myself getting elected. Ward boundary changes pushed it out of the ward.
Actually, no. Garden City has been in Old Kildonan since at least 1998 when I ran for city council.
I was referring to the library.
Okay, right. Okay. You were saying that you think there is a demand from the public, the people who live in the, and it's not, these libraries are established for areas like you mentioned and like the report mentions. It's not about wards necessarily. It's about areas. You said you think that the people want the library to be moved. You said think. Have you done any public engagement consultation with people in terms of them wanting that library to be moved and expanded and meeting today's requirements of the library services?
I don't just think, Councillor Eadie, I feel very strongly that we need a modern library in North Winnipeg. We have, Seven Oaks School Division has just opened a new school in Amber Trails. They have a new one coming online that speaks strongly to the fact that we have new families moving into the area. And with that, we need amenities like a modern public library. And it just doesn't exist. And as I said, I think having something like this in North Winnipeg will benefit Minarski, Point Douglas Ward, and our citizens across the city, because folks do use multiple libraries. That's a fact. I've had many conversations as well with our department on this file and Mr. Rick Walker. They get feedback from the public through 311 and other mechanisms. I've represented the area for the last 5 years, so yes, I feel very strongly that this amenity is lacking. And I very much support the report in front of us today.
That's how you feel. Okay. The original plan said 2021 based on library needs across the whole city. You're seeing that there was an opening because somehow a new city councilor decided in another area that the plan didn't work. Do you think that the people who live in the St. Charles, Assiniboia area are okay with not having their new centrally located modern library having that put off till 2021?
That's a good question, and I think we should defer to Councillor Dobson on that, and I'm sure we'll be hearing from him shortly.
Okay, great.
Thank you, Councillor Eady. Any other questions of the Councillor Shryer, and then Councillor Wyatt?
Councillor Wyatt can continue with his questions if he wishes. I can leave.
Okay, Councillor Wyatt.
Do you have any idea what the budget of the new library will be?
I don't have that at my fingertips, but I did mention that there's no financial impact to the capital budget because this is a leased facility. And so the two projects, the Westwood Library and the West Caldone new library, would be of the same scope.
So where would the impact occur then?
I'd like to hear from the administration on that.
So if there's no impact on the capital budget, that means it's going to be a lease.
Yes.
So if it's a lease, there's an impact on the operating budget.
We'll hear those details later. You can ask the administration.
So, okay. But right now, we don't have an idea of what that will be in terms of the increase in the operating costs of the Department of Community Services.
The projects are of the same scope. That's what's written in the report here. They're saying there's not a minimal financial impact. As for the nitty-gritty details, I suggest you ask the administration when the item comes up in your meeting today.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Shryer?
Councillor Eady can go ahead if he wishes on his line of questioning.
Actually, I just thought of it, but in an offhand way, it does have an effect on the capital budget in that the city won't have to maintain renovate an asset that exists at the moment. Then I guess you could say the same for the Westwood area as well. Anyway.
Thank you, Councillor Eady. Councillor Shryer.
Thank you, Chair Pactican. I'm the only new member of council that's on this committee today and at this table, given Councillor Sharma's re-election. So I certainly hope I'm not asking questions that you feel aren't relevant to your delegation here today and your request. But I'm just trying to get my head around this. Council unanimously voted in favor of the library plan. And could I get from someone, perhaps yourself, Councillor Sharma, when council voted on the library plan, that means that in which the library would inevitably move to your ward by 2021.
When did we vote on it?
Yeah.
Several years ago, and I don't have the voting record with me. So but I can't tell you if it was unanimous.
Okay, fair enough.
It was unanimous.
I get the, I just feel that it was, but maybe it wasn't, but I feel there would have been consensus on it, the library plan. Were you a counselor at the time?
Yes, I was.
You were, okay, so It was within the last 4 years. Okay, fair enough. So it is the intention. We're moving in the direction that we're intending. We're just trying to speed up the process. Is what you're requesting?
That's right. The timeline really concerns me, as I mentioned, and you know the area quite well, Councillor Schreier. We have been growing by leaps and bounds. I don't think we could have anticipated the kind of development that's in front of us. Yes, there was a vote a few years ago, but things change, and it's our job as elected representatives to bring things forward when we feel a change needs to occur, and that's what I'm doing here today.
Fair enough. So you're saying in the last 3 or 4 years that despite the fact that the move of the library into your ward, I assume, is based on changing demographics and weighted in favor of where the development is moving in the city, in that area of the city, that despite the fact that was understood, I assume that was understood. Otherwise, why would we intend to move it in that direction? So, but you're saying, even though would you agree that we knew development was happening in your ward, and that was the direction that the library should go into your ward? The council knew that when they voted on the library plan?
I guess the other piece of this, Councillor Schreier, and we'll hear from Councillor Dobson, I guess, shortly. We have a new representative in St. Charles, and he's feeling differently. He's hearing things from his residents. So a swap here makes sense, right? It's aligning. It seems to make sense. Mm-hmm. So we're not looking at the old Caledonian Ward in isolation. I think we're looking at the timeline going forward of three different projects, and the public service is recommending this as an option.
Sure. You say three projects. I understand the one for Councillor Dobson's ward, this one, and what's the third?
Yeah, there's the St. James Library, I believe, in the mix as well.
Okay. So you're saying that they're part and parcel of this dynamic of switching. Are you saying that when this was brought forth to the administration by the previous incarnation of this committee a month or so ago, within the last number of weeks, for a recommendation from the administration, that the administration was looking at this as part and parcel of Councillor Dobson's decision? Not to prioritize his prerogative of having his library moved first?
I'm not sure of that, Councillor Schreier, but what I can tell you is when I brought this issue forward, I wasn't aware of Councillor Dobson's position.
Okay, and I don't think administration was either. I'm just assuming, having said that, Councillor Pactican, Chair Pactican, do we have anyone here from administration?
We'll have an opportunity later on when we hit the report.
Fair enough. So I just want you to know, I'm in favor of what council, I think by consensus, unanimously felt was the natural evolution and development of the region and how that affects the placement of the library, that it would inevitably move into your ward. And it's a question of expediting this, which was the intention independent of Councillor Dobson's coincidental decision based on what he feels are the priorities of his ward, and so it offers the opportunity to move this one first. Fair enough. And I guess for me, all of questions for administration. And so it's a question of doing this. So I just, for the record, I want to say I concur with council's decision to support the library plan, which inevitably moves the library into your ward. I'm in favor of that. So it's just a question of when and how. So, Councillor Sharma, you're looking at expediting this, and given your explanations, I see this as a legitimate consideration. But if we're going to have council control over something that is already sort of in the works, it's already happening. It's already part of the administration's directive. So this is already rolling along. But because we want to expedite this by council decision, I think this is an opportunity, because it's not just about perhaps moving this ahead of time, but to look at other considerations as well that I think as councillors were equally or perhaps equally or near equally, in a position to affect progressively. It's not just a question then of moving this ahead of time, because it's moving there anyway. So what advantage can we take in expediting this, in changing the course of things by having councillors involved and committees involved? So I just want you to know that I know your ward, I know that area, I still live in the area, and I also know the Jefferson Library. At one point, that was my favorite library. At one point, my favorite library was Sir William Stevenson, because it's a great library. The issue is the placement of it now. At least there's certain aspects of accessibility that are wonderful in terms of the Jefferson Library. If we're going to move this ahead of time, if we're going to expedite this, I would be very regretful for us to make a decision in which, you know, certain other aspects of progressive thinking and equitability and all these things aren't taken into consideration. Right now, accessibility at the current location, I would say, is excellent. Do we expedite this beyond the plan at the expense of accessibility? So what I'm saying to you, Madam Sharma, Councillor Sharma, I hope you don't consider it sort of new or a surprise, but maybe we're in a position to actually, you know, make the most out of expediting this and changing the course of the natural course of the library plan, and not forsaking other factors that go along with.
Councillor Schreier, can I just interject? Are you aware that accessibility is substandard in that location? There's spatial challenges internal to the building. Parking's an issue. So it's a great neighborhood library that serves a small catchment.
Well,
accessibility is not excellent.
My ability to park in front of there by car is good. I also know that the access routes.
Can you just ask a question if you don't mind?
Sure. I guess my question is: Are we willing, while we move forward, if we're going to expedite this, take into consideration, you know, people's concerns for what we're discussing right now, accessibility, and that we don't that this isn't this that this isn't forsaken. Would you go along with me that these things are sort of paramount in finding a new home for a community or regional library?
What is your question, sir?
That these concerns of accessibility are paramount, especially if we're going to move this along quicker than the natural plan asked. That we're in a position to make sure that these concerns are addressed of accessibility.
Accessibility is very important. I do take it very seriously.
Okay.
I have the pleasure of sitting on the accessibility committee with Councillor Eady. He's the chair. It's also, West Kay Library is not located on a main thoroughfare with excellent, you know, bus access. Or the parking is not good. There's more parking at the fire hall down the street on McGregor. Again, my focus is not West Kay. I love the library. I frequent it regularly. We're looking for a modern facility for North Winnipeg, and it's lacking right now. It's inadequate.
Fair enough. And to me, a modern location means accessibility. This is the era we're in. It happens to be that it's nice that the current location is nicely nestled in a neighborhood. And maybe it gives the impression of lack of accessibility because of its residential setting. Councillor Sharma, let me assure you, I mean, when I go there...
Councillor Sharma, what's your question, sir?
Whether we can work together on a process by which accessibility and sort of future-oriented aspects by which we make decisions are going to be taken into consideration, especially when we're going to mitigate, instigate speeding up the process. That if council's going to have extra control over this, we take advantage of that to make sure it's in an extra good location.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay.
And I believe when we get to the stage of expression of interest, there's a pre-tendering process that we follow here at the city. where there will be public consultation, and I have faith in our public administration that they will do that to the best of their ability.
Okay, so are you saying, Councillor Sharma, that the factors that enter into this are not merely lowest bid?
I think we should direct that question to our director, Clive Whiteman. Fair. We will hear from him later.
Fair enough. So I ask of you, Councillor Sharma, would you say that there are factors involved by which you would make a decision that it's not based on merely lowest bid, that there's certain issues that we're obliged to take into consideration, including aspects of accessibility?
We'll have ultimate decision at a later date on location. I think what's before us today is changing the order.
Right, and I'm saying if we're going to go and do this and go beyond what council's already decided on in the plan, which inevitably moves the library into your ward, is it just about speeding this up by virtue of demographics that are faster than was perceived, even though it was already perceived that they are moving in a new direction? That's why the library is going into your library anyway. If council's going to take control over this now, are we now not in a position to sort of make the best decision and include in this to weigh the factors, including other issues of accessibility and
Councillor Shire, sorry to interrupt. Sure. Just if you can make the question succinct to the point regarding the issue at hand.
Councillor Sharma, thank you, Chair Patrick. Are you in favor of prioritizing factors of accessibility and other such issues that the public will raise? I can't predict them all. Over merely lowest bid in this process.
Yeah, I agree with you, Councillor Schreier. I think all of those things will come up during the expression of interest. There's a point system, I believe, and many things are taken into consideration. Accessibility, are you on a major thoroughfare where there's bus access, etc.? So that's a conversation for a later date, but I hear what you're saying, and many factors need to be taken into consideration, and I hope it's just not price.
Okay, you do. Because for me, you're saying these issues, part of process, there's a point system, and again, it falls on the administration. But the administration already gave its recommendation a few years ago, on which the council already voted, I think, unanimously, in favor of moving this into your ward. You're asking for us to make a decision now, as councillors, to expedite this. And on that basis, I'm asking for you, as a councillor who wants to take manual control of this issue right now, beyond the administration's directive, what are you going to prioritize? You're asking us to make a decision.
I'm actually not taking manual control. I asked a question, and we have a report for us. I did not pen this report. The administration did.
Fair enough. I mean, was it not your request that they do?
Yes, it was. Okay. As I'm sure you will have future requests. They're
okay.
Important to you.
So, no, fair enough, and this is all good, Councillor Sharma. What I'm saying is, I don't have a problem with this, so long as if we're going to go beyond the plan.
Councillor Shire, I'm sorry. We're just trying to follow out. You know what? I just was talking to the clerk. We follow the same rules here in council, which is basically three questions, like
okay.
First, second, third. I've been pretty generous with you.
Yes, you should have.
And so I'm gonna, if you don't mind, I want to ask a couple of questions. And then,
just so you know, Chair Pacticano, I didn't realize in my entire time on the Standing Committee of the Year, I wasn't aware of this.
Okay. Fair enough. Okay.
Thank you for your passion.
Questions,
yeah. Okay, Councillor Sharma, so you said basically you're not here talking about the location of a proposed library in Northwest Winnipeg. You're just saying that because of the growth that's occurring, you're saying that you support the change in the proposed order. In the redevelopment strategy, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Eadie.
Councillor Sharma, would you agree that Jefferson is a main thoroughfare for the largest part of your ward called the Maples?
It is a main thoroughfare, Councillor Eadie.
Right. Okay.
My point
earlier is that
the West Kildonan Library serves a small catchment. We need to widen the reach for library services.
Are you aware that many people who live in the Maples utilize that library at the corner of Powers and Jefferson?
I am aware of that. Many years ago when I lived in the Maples, I was using library services through something called a bookmobile. Do you recall those?
Well, that's back in the olden days, yeah.
Yeah.
That's when people weren't driving, I guess.
Olden days.
It's time that we bring the area up to standard.
Is it because you couldn't take a bus from, say, Adsum in Manila, where the regional pool is? You couldn't take a bus from there down to Powers to get a book?
It was just easier to walk with my five siblings down the street to the bookmobile.
I see. Okay. So local service is what you're talking about, not regional services, right?
We need a modern facility for Northwood. No, that is my
You're saying the new...
Probably historic.
So anyway, I just want to clarify, you're making a statement that Jefferson is not a main thoroughfare. It's a main thoroughfare in Old and West.
It's not a main
point
of access, Councilor Eady, for people that live in Riverbend, that live in Amber Trails.
Right, Riverbend, yeah. Is that the...
River Grove.
Yeah, anyway, because you're talking about services, right? So, libraries are utilized all times of the day, different people, seniors probably more in non-peak hours, people that travel buses. It seems to me some areas in your ward had reduced local bus service to serve new areas. Is that correct?
That's the topic for today.
All right. Just asking because you're very concerned, I know, about people's access to city services such as libraries, bus service, and so on. So I'm just asking.
Yeah, I know the direction you're headed. Yeah.
All right. Well, no, I just... Okay. All right.
Any other questions for Councillor Sharma?
I'm not aware of where Councillor Eady is headed.
Never mind.
Debate that we had on a certain bus.
All right. Okay. Fair enough. I'm aware of
that serves senior citizens.
Fair enough. I just want to say, Councillor Sharma, I agree we need to widen reach and we need a modern facility. A modern facility would take into considerations maybe in my opinion, and it's my prerogative, that don't coincide exactly with the administration's point system. You're saying we're going to, that they'll make a recommendation on their point system. But my value system, my point system, my weighing system might be different. The public's might be different as well. I don't know how they're going to evaluate this. But if we're going to expedite this beyond the plan, which moves it into your ward anyway, let's make the best decision possible. And I don't want a second-rate location and call it a modern facility. And that is my primary concern if we're going to expedite this, to make a long story short. And on that basis, I don't know how we're going to do that exactly, what goes from here, but I just want you to know that since it was your request to take this to administration for the recommendation that expedites this 4 years ahead of time from the original plan that council voted on, then you know what? That's not wrong to me. It's not wrong to me, but it's not right unto itself. If it's, because there's other factors involved.
Yeah, Councillor Sharma. Okay. Councillor
I'm done. Schreier. Thank you, Chair.
Yeah. Thank you. There's no other questions. Thank you, Councillor Sharma. Appreciate it.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Councillor Dobson is next.
Now we have Councillor Dobson. Good morning. It's
good here?
Yeah. Or, yeah, that's fine.
Okay. I would be Councillor Dobson. Now on this Westwood Library move, over the summer, I've been there probably 20 times and I've looked and it's very well served. It has an elevator, it has a wheelchair ramp. I understand it is small. Down the road it would be nice to get a larger facility, but with our budget concerns right now, I don't think the Westwood Library is a good move right now. You have to understand there's more than just moving the library. The plot of land that it encompasses also includes the Allard Arena. To sell or to make that library vacant, it means that we're going to have to either sell the property or have a vacant building, and that's not good in the short term or in the long term. If we waited a little bit longer, it may be make more financial sense to renovate and move. And that's That's it. That's all I got today.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor. Questions for Councillor Dobson. Councillor Eadie?
Yes, Councillor Dobson. So our report is saying there's no budget impacts related to this switch in priority. Are you aware of that?
Yes, I am.
Okay. So have you actually... So you're thinking people are okay with the library, the Westwood Library as is, or is that correct?
That is correct. It's been there for 30 or 40 years. If we wait a few more years and to make the move properly, I think that would be better.
So you've heard the consideration about the West Goldoman Library. It sounds like the Westwood Library, if you're looking at it, is serving a immediate local area, people who are close by to it. Is that how you look at it, or...?
Well, there's a number of people that use it. I've talked to a number of people in the library that have visited it, and they're from all over the ward, primarily, of course, in the local area, though.
Right. So very similar library then to the West Goldoman Library, is that correct?
I'm not 100%.
Well, you're not familiar with our West Goldoman Library, but what you just made a comment is that is very similar to the operations at the West Goldoman Library. But so anyway, I'm just curious because, you know, there has been a number of Westwood Library's been there for 40 years or even, like, that building's almost 50 years old, isn't it?
Could be.
Yeah. So since then, there's been a lot of development in the area within your ward, but also within the general area, is that right?
No, actually, once that was built, our area is pretty confined by the perimeter highway and by the river and Saskatchewan Avenue, so development really hasn't increased since it was built.
So the Westwood Library is not considered to be a regional library, it's considered to be a local library, or?
Well, not sure the context we're looking for here.
Well, anyway, all I wanted to know is, have you actually... the residents of your ward would probably be quite excited if it was a bigger, better facility, and it was scheduled for 2017. Do you think that the residents in your whole ward, whole area there, do you think that they are going to be happy that they could have had a much better library 2017 versus 2021 now?
Of course, you have to take that into consideration, but we also have to look at spending our money wisely. Right now, as I said before, to sell that library, to move the location would leave a footprint on that piece of property that would not be a good thing. If we wait a few years, when the Allard Arena, perhaps the ice plant fails, and then the two properties, we could move at that time.
So, well, do you believe that your community would prefer to have a hockey rink where there is to replace one and have some sheets of ice there? Or?
Well, if the Allard Arena ever failed, then we'll have to make the decision on whether we rebuild on site or move to another site.
I don't know if you're aware of this, so it's an are you aware question. Are you aware that the City of Winnipeg has taken a property that exists in St. Vitale, and it's been apportioned, and they sold part of it and kept part of it for recreation? Are you aware that the city has done those kind of things in the past?
Well, I'm sure they have. I'm just pointing out this particular piece of property. If we could find another use for the actual library, because the building is sound, if we could find another use for it, then that would be a consideration. But currently...
Would there be a community group interested in buying that building to utilize it for its needs?
Again, that could be a consideration, perhaps in 2021.
Well, anyway, so you're telling me, though, you don't know if the people who live in your ward are okay with putting off having a nice modern library facility for another 4 years versus it could have happened in, see, you don't know, right?
Well, actually, when I canvassed, that was a big issue for a lot of people, and predominantly they wanted it to stay.
Is that right?
Yes.
Hmm. Okay.
Thank you, Councillor Eadie. Any other questions of Councillor Dobson?
Actually, I did have one. Before you were elected, did you even know there was a library redevelopment strategy?
No.
So you actually consulted, and that was an issue when you were campaigning in 2014?
It was a huge issue.
Okay. All right.
Thank you, Councillor Eadie. Councillor Dobson, thanks for coming out and speaking to it. I have a question for you. Can you just elaborate on why that was an issue for you, or why that was an issue in the campaign, and just so that I can understand why it was an issue?
Okay. Apparently, now this is just a rumor, of course. This is what people were telling me at the door, that the intention was to sell the arena and move the library and redevelop that piece of land. And my thoughts, of course, were that the arena is functioning. We really don't want to take down an arena that's perfectly good. It just makes no sense. That's it.
So how did that, why was that related to the library redevelopment in terms of that area?
Well, because they're on the same piece of land.
Okay.
They have, they use the same parking lot. The library, its footprint is a little bit smaller than the Allard Arena. But again, it's such a small piece of land that if we move the library, I can't see us disposing of that land when in reality we could probably use it later on. It would be make more financial sense.
Thank you. So in the report, you support the recommendation of the report that the Westwood Library plan for 2017 be moved to the 2021 replacement schedule?
I think that would be a wise move, yes.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions for Councillor Dobson? Councillor Schreier?
Thank you, Chair Pachtakam. So, Councillor Dobson, what's the relevance to you of 2021?
There is no particular relevance. Further down the road would make more sense.
So you're not recommending 2021?
No.
Okay. So this is about changing the of trading places in chronology. So you're not necessarily in support of trading places in chronology with the move of the West Kildare Library. It's not, you just don't want to move. You just don't want to.
I don't think at this time the Westwood Library should be relocated. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, and you don't 2021. Do you know? Of course, remember when we had the library plan a few years ago? They were looking into the future and made some decisions. They had to make a decision on some sort of foresight. So I'm not asking you to do anything else than what the council did, 3 or 4 years ago when they had a library plan and made these decisions. In your judgment, and it's yours to make, and it's your consultation with your ward. So I'm asking you. There is nobody better to ask, arguably than yourself. 2021 action doesn't mean anything to you. It's just a year that the administration's offered for this. You're not asking for 2021.
Question, Secretary Councillor Shire.
Are you in favor of 2021 for the library plan for your ward?
2021 or 2023, 2025. It doesn't matter so much. It's very hard to predict 4 years down the road.
Okay. So this is all arbitrary to you. You're not asking for 2021. It's coming out of thin air to you.
Correct.
So, okay. So you're not necessarily in favor of this. You didn't ask for it.
Just so I can help you here, I think to answer your question, Councillor Dobson can let me know if I'm correct.
What Councillor Dobson, I think, is trying to say is that he's in favor of changing the order from the first part of the schedule of the three libraries to the third. Is that correct, Councillor Dobson?
That would be much better, yes.
But we didn't ask for it. It wasn't a specific request for him to the administration. Okay, I just want to get this clear, because there's other things I'll be mentioning later on in the meeting on this issue, which I think is relevant.
Any other questions of the councillor at this point? Councillor Dobson, thank you very much for your time.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
There's no more delegations on any items at this point. Okay, so we'll move into the reports. Report number one is a renaming of the Winnipeg Soccer Complex to Ralph Cantafio Soccer. And I believe we're looking for
a 30-day layover.
Looking for 30 days on this one.
So moved.
By Councillor Wyatt, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Next item is the proposed changing of the order of the library replacement within the library redevelopment strategy. I know we've got some questions from the Councillor, of the Public Service. Rick Walker, good morning. Clive Whiteman, good morning.
Councillors, Madam Chairman.
Okay, Councillors, questions of our administration?
Actually, I have a question for about. I'm trying to get a sense of who is actually coming and using the existing West Kildonan Library. And so I was just made aware that, and it's interesting that if it's only serving people in a very small area right now, I'm wondering how they actually won the battery and cell phone collection contest during a competition during the week in which it collected the most poundage of batteries. I'm just wondering if it's possible that they could win it by only having people provide batteries from immediately around Jefferson and Powers.
Sorry, Councillor, I don't understand.
Well, the West Kildonan Library recently won a contest. So I'm just trying to get an idea of the people that are using the facility right now, because there was a number of decisions made in coming up with this strategy in terms of priority and so on, originally back in 2012.
Sorry, sir, just your question. There's a contest you're saying between all libraries?
So all libraries in the city, okay, right, collecting batteries. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that this little library that sits at Jefferson and Powers actually won the contest throughout the city, beating big, nice big libraries that serve all in North Kildonan, for example, on Henderson Highway.
I can try to answer that for you, Councillor.
But do you think that people going to that library, seeing the posters and stuff and brought up from all around the Maples and all around the ward of Old Kildonan?
So we can't tell that, but West Kildonan Library is what we call an area library, so it does serve a large catchment area. So it's open a large number of hours, has large collections, provides a number of amenities. And we know that library users will use more than one branch. So, for example, they may use the St. John's Library, which is close to the West Kildonan Library. They may use Henderson Library across the river in North Kildonan. People do travel to their different libraries. Our challenges, of course,
Sir William Stevenson Library.
And Sir William Stevenson Library. Our challenges, of course, are trying to find a good location for our new facilities as they come online that will serve as wide a community as possible.
I do have a question. Why did Westwood get prioritized for 2017 versus the West Kildonan Library in 2021? What was the original thinking there? Was there more of a need in the St. Charles area?
Well,
than in the Old Kildonan, West Kildonan area?
As we outlined in the plan, the branches that were done that are being done in the earlier years, there was greater need there. The ones that are from 17 to 19, They're similar in scope and nature, similar in the issues associated with them. They're older buildings. They have accessibility issues. There's functionality issues in terms of the amenities that people are looking for in their public libraries today. They have limited parking. They have maintenance issues associated with them, but not as significant as the ones that were in the earlier years. So as we said in the report, at least there was an opportunity with those last three, Westwood, West K, and St. James, that if
the order was
you're right. The order was actually Westwood, St. James, West K. Those three, there is at least an opportunity that if it's council's will, that there could be a change in order. The issue is, of course, they're not necessarily apples to apples. Westwood and West Kildonan are both proposed for leased facilities. West St. James is proposed for a replacement facility.
Why was that?
Potential to even build on the existing site because of the property, the location, and other amenities there.
That would be the property.
It has that opportunity.
So in developing the strategy, though, you were looking at, from the library user perspective who are already using these facilities. So there was no public engagement with the actual community areas in which we're talking about moving. There's no public consultation about, you know, do you even want to move the library and so on.
Well, you know, we looked at all of the branches and the issues associated with them, the age, the maintenance requirements, those capital costs that you talked about, the accessibility, the significant accessibility issues associated with them. They were built in another time. Maintenance issues, access to the buildings, functionality issues, not having the amenities that people are asking for in public libraries today. So all of those were looked at to place them in an order. The consultation parts of it come as part of, as the branches come online. So when branches come online, we do a pre-tendering consultation where we ask the community what are the sorts of amenities they would like to see in their branches. That's sort of phase one. In the cases of these leased facilities, of course, we would go out for an expression of interest from the community to find proponents that would suggest locations for the library. That would be brought back to the political level for consideration. We'll do our due diligence on that. We'll certainly talk about the criteria that we would place on those proponents in terms of what we're looking for in a library. But ultimately, that's deciding the location issue. After we've that's been awarded, of course, we would do further consultation with the community to share plans for what we're proposing to be built in working with the architect.
Okay. When was the Westwood Library built?
When was the Westwood Library built?
Yeah, I know Westgate is 1967.
Yeah, it's 68, I think. It's coming up on its 50th.
Around the same year.
Around the same time. I think it's about a year apart from Westgate and Westgate.
I've been in both libraries. Would you say the spatial issues in Westwood are a lot tighter than at the West Kildonan Library?
You know, it's hard for me to say that. Certainly, they both have spatial needs.
They're not like the Henderson Highway.
Absolutely not.
Big, flat. Yeah.
And certainly, they're not like the new Charleswood Library. They are crowded. They were not built for the collections that they have today, for that size of collection. They don't have the space for study tables, for leisure space, for the program amenities that we're trying to provide people today. So. So they are both crowded. They are both crowded buildings.
So the other question I have is, if you say 2017, is that actually when you start consulting about what are you looking for in a library, that whole location thing, does that begin
correct.
In 2017?
That's correct. Right. You know, we can't move forward until the monies are in place and part of the capital budget. So although the monies would be available in 17 for a branch, in all likelihood it wouldn't be built that year. that's the consultation pieces and working through the architects.
And a lease wouldn't happen in that year either? Or?
Probably not.
No. Okay. I think that's all of the questions I had.
Councilor Schreier?
Reason for the report. It says on September 30th, 2015, Council concurred with the recommendation of the Executive Policy Committee directing the Public Service to report back to the Policy Committee and Protection Community Services at its October 2015 meeting with options and implications of revising the schedule of library redevelopment. So it was completely independent of this option of rotating chronology. When I look back council decision, the therefore be it resolved clause, that council direct the public service to report back to the Standing Policy Committee at its October 2015 meeting with options and implications of advancing the date of the new leased library facility within the old Kildonan ward from 2017 from 2021. So, okay, I'm just saying one with this in the report back, it's an italics as if it's a quote, but it's not a quote. It was specifically moving it. Councillor Sharma did ask us specifically to move it, this committee to move it, to ask the administration to move it from 2021 to 2017. So I just want to state for the record, because I don't have a problem with this, I'm just trying to state for the record, it was a councillor and with councillors to ask the administration, you know, give them directive for us to sort of take control of this, to ask the administration to look at expediting this. This was councillors did this, not the administration, to look at this. We're now working with a administrative recommendation on this, a report back. But I just want to make this clear. This is not the administration's did this on its own. They were dealing with the library plan. Councillors made a point of doing this. So my point is, you know, I'm inconsistent with this. I don't have a problem with that. I'm saying if we're going to go about and change directives as councillors to the administration, and then, you know, let's look at priorities. Let's do it. I mean, demographic movement, great priority. I understand. What else is there? So I look at this report and it says, the new West Kildonan Library, more strategically located in the community and accessible via various transportation needs, would provide a new fully accessible facility that better meets the library needs of the entire community. Okay, that's great. But I just hope my concern is that accessibility via various transportation means means that accessibility isn't just by virtue of there being bus routes, but there's accessibility. Why rush and put in place in 2 years instead of four a new library with potentially a 20-year contract? What's the rush if it's going to be, you know, we're not looking at all things that we can as councillors, independent of the library strategy, just a big issue to me. That's all. And if you could say in your own words what it says, offer options and implications. Oh, what options are you offering? Excuse me if this hasn't been clear to me.
There's really the options for consideration are either doing a swap of two leased facilities, of not doing a swap, and put in not in with the Westwood Library being moved to another year, or leaving everything as is. So when we look at your comment about what the councillors are considering, so there would be no opportunity to do a swap, right? If the Westwood Library was not being considered to be moved a few years down the road, so that's the first thing. So the conversation could only happen on that. That's netting zero. Alternatively, of course, West Kildonan could be advanced, right, into that year without moving the Westwood Library out at all. But the councillor has, you know, based on his community intelligence, is suggesting to us that could happen a few years down the road. So status quo, swap, you know, advance without swap, those are, but from a fiscal perspective, on the capital side of the coin, because these are both leases, we're just going to be swapping out the city's commitment, because on top of the city's commitment also there's going to be leasehold improvements, considerable leasehold improvements negotiated, you know, for the property owner to improve the site also. So that swap, it really is netting zero on the lease side and the capital side. The operating side, of course, when we look at each facility that will no longer be serving the public, those operational costs are a little bit different between two branches. So that and that consideration comes when the approval to move forward occurs. So in the instance of Charleswood, for example, you know, the operational costs of the old facility would then be ported into the new facility, and then we look at net incremental potentially costs of a facility that may be, in the instance of Charleswood, three times as large, for example. And we mitigate some of those incremental costs through, as Rick has said, design, customer service points on one floor versus multiple customer service points. So we actually improve the operational efficiency of these buildings being on one pad versus multiple layers of, you know, stairs and elevators and things like that. And we'll come back with that information after we get the costs associated with the design, right? And then you can sort of understand what the impact on the operations are. Then we come back with a report on each individual redevelopment/replacement, right, for council's consideration. Because all of those detailed numbers then come back for approval again, and then you'll see the operational side, our best guesses of and estimates of what that might be. And as I said before, on the capital side, it's just the lease costs being swapped. One is, I believe, is about 1.4, and up, and the first one is 1.2. So, and that 1.4 really comes with sort of a cost of living incremental amount that we bumped up on. So we would just take the Westwood branch in this instance, if it was the will of council, and it would be moved back, and it would have 1.4 for leasehold improvements on our side, and the West Kildonan redevelopment would have the $1.2 million, which in effect are the same dollars except for 4 years of cost of living applied to it.
I have a couple of questions of Clyde. So I was reading this report, and the evaluation as to the reasoning for moving it is, it mentions that Councillor Sharma wishes have it moved in 2017. Councillor Dobson doesn't really care. He's basically saying there's no need at all to change the Westwood Library. It doesn't reflect the councillor from, there's a councillor missing in there in terms of councillor. Would you agree with that?
I would respond to that question in this manner. I would suggest that when council adopted the redevelopment strategy, it was acknowledged in that strategy that the West Kildonan branch,
2021, right?
Right, in the overall strategy.
Do you know why the councillor for the area thought 2021 was okay?
In the
I voted for it.
In the evaluation, as Rick has said, The second phase of library redevelopment, which is the last three projects of eight, I believe, those we feel,
years right, those
right, we felt that those could have been interchangeable based on the similarities between the last three pieces, and that's all we're saying. And if it's is it the public service taking a look at the disposition? Is there an opportunity to do this? But at the end of the day, that opportunity and moving forward with that opportunity, it will be a political decision.
It's political. So you're looking at political stuff, but do you agree this has implications for the two areas in question here, the Old Kildonan and West Kildonan area versus the Westwood trying to remember all the neighborhoods. Crestview.
Every one
of whole host of neighborhoods.
Yeah, well,
there.
Every one of these.
No. I'm just asking you a question. So in doing this analysis, you're not really giving consideration to how the people would feel, whether they want, they would prefer to have it earlier than later?
We know.
That's not part of your analysis, right?
No.
Okay, thanks.
Councillor Schreier?
Thank you.
I'm sorry, Councillor Wyatt. Thank you, Councillor Schreier.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Okay, that's why I kind of bring down the volume a little bit in terms of the politicization of this issue. Couple of questions, and I know we've probably had these discussions before, and so they're not new questions. I'll ask this question because I think I've had it asked to me actually from the general public, and that is, in the age of e-books and online services and everything, are physical libraries a thing of the past?
They're more relevant than they've ever been.
Okay.
All right. So, I mean, as far, and I'll, Rick can provide some detail.
I just want to ask that
but
question.
As far as,
that was a quick answer.
As far as community, serving community, getting people together, looking at different technologies that can be offered to community, makerspace, all of what a new library looks like is completely different than an old library. Libraries are places for community to meet. When you went to the library as a kid and you had a librarian tell you to be quiet and shush you, that doesn't happen. We encourage dialogue and interaction.
I would have actually gone to the library more often.
So if you look around what's happening,
I'm not being shushed anymore. Yeah,
if you look at what's happening in the world across North America, libraries are only increasing in their relevance in serving community.
And can you elaborate? Why is it? Why? I'm just asking. It's a question that people have asked me.
Sure, Clive's touched on a lot of the points here. You know, while our collections are still being used, they're a smaller part of our overall operation. People are using our program rooms, so we're doing a lot more adult and children's programming. We have tutorial spaces where students can meet. I think it's what Clive says, a lot of collaboration going on. People use the library for a study place, they're a meeting place, a place of leisure. It's a place where they can just congregate. There's not a lot of places in our communities today that are free and open and accessible, and they are community hubs. And so what we're finding is people are using us for the technology, so there's still a lot of digital divide between those that have and those that do not. So whether it's using our public access computers or the free Wi-Fi being able to access on their own devices, we're finding people are using us for a lot of different reasons now. And
attendance
and
keeps going up.
Yeah.
The bottom line, too, is that when you look at the service offering in the library, I believe there's about 3,500, 3,400 programs that are offered annually in our library branches for community. So is it different? Absolutely it's different than I was when I was a kid. It's morphed into what it needs to do, which is, meet the needs of the communities that we're serving.
I think our best example of that is the new Charleswood Library, because we moved from a 4,000-square-foot facility to a 14,000-square-foot facility, and we're now, that library is just booming in all categories. Increased programming, increased attendance, higher number of questions, higher traffic volumes, and increased circulation. So there clearly is a demand and a need for the space, the physical space of our libraries today.
So how do you determine a local or a neighborhood library versus a regional library? What is the determination that goes into that?
Well, we currently have a system that's made up of area, community, and neighborhood libraries. But as we're replacing our branches, I think what we're seeing is there's more of flatlining going on. Our branches are more, on average, about 14,000 square feet of space. That's a good model for us. We know that it works. We can see that with Charleswood Library. We have to have a certain amount of parking, but, to speak to Councillor Schreier's comment, People get to libraries in all ways. So they come by bus, they come by car, they walk, they bike. So we want to be on those active transportation routes. We want to be on transit routes. We want to be on high visible routes to get to our locations, because people come there for that or maybe for other amenities and other services too. So all of those are factors that go that come into play.
So the West Kelowna Library would be in that range of size?
Absolutely, yeah. You know, it's currently about 12,000 square feet on two floors, so about 6,000 square feet per floor. The idea is to build a single-story facility on one floor, about 14,000 square feet, and until we, you know, until we work with somebody, we don't know exactly, but about 14,000 is what we would place in an EOI to ask for information, and we can move from there.
And what factors, you know, you mentioned, you talked a bit about leasing and leasehold improvements, and those costs strike me as being a lot less than having to build and operate and own a facility, at least the cost up front to us. Why are we not simply going out and leasing properties, and we could implement this strategy probably in half as much time as it would be required as when we're building facilities?
Well, you know, it makes sense in certain cases. Part of it is access to city land. Part of it is, as communities are developing and growing, we want to be able to be in a flexible position so that should we want to move some point in the future, we have that option. It's exactly why we chose to do a lease with the Charleswood Library. 15 years out from now, which is the length of term of that lease, that whole part of Winnipeg will see considerable growth in the housing and the development in that area. Where we are currently may not be the center or the hub for that community, and that'll give us an opportunity to at least examine that and determine whether we should relocate the library at that point. A leased facility allows us that option.
So I guess following up on my question, I appreciate the answer, would we not, should we not be looking at leasing everything?
In terms let's use St. James as an example. When you have a piece of property that we already own that you can accommodate that expansion on, so tearing down and rebuilding, when you look at the net present value, right, because land is not an option on that because we already own the land, when you look at the net present value of lease versus build, there's an intersection that occurs depending on the costs involved, right? But when you're 20, 30 years down the road, you still have an advantage with a lease facility. So, but when you move out to 60, 70 years, and a lot of our library facilities, as Councillor Eady is well aware, we're celebrating some pretty significant milestones in the century mark. You know, so that's, you know, where you sort of see that own versus lease start to turn the other way. But as Winnipeg grows and expands, the problem with the opportunity that lease facilities afford is the opportunity to strategically reconsider, you know, where the library needs to be in serving community. So if there was a huge amount of growth, for example, and I think Rick's referring to Ridgewood South, there potentially will be 5,000, I think up to 5,000 units built there, you know, 10, 15,000 people. So 15 years down the road, we take a look. We have an opportunity to extend the lease by five-year pieces. So we have so we could extend another 5 years or another 10, waiting for that development. But then when the opportunity comes to reevaluate, you know, are we serving the community in the right place, we have that option to go back then and either release or consider a build.
Your library program and the expansion is it's quite a unique opportunity, I think, in terms of doing things differently. One of the things that I've heard from the public that they'd like to see more of in terms of the library expansion and the whole replacement strategy
is ensuring that there's opportunity inside libraries to, you know, if they're in a library, they'd like to be also be able to go get a cup of coffee, maybe a dainty, you know, this sort of thing. And so are we ensuring that when we go out, whether we lease or whether we build, that we're providing inside the libraries leasing opportunities to the private sector, that so it would actually be a revenue piece to the library services and a service piece to our community, that folks want to see this. They want to have the ability to be able to have the Starbucks sort of phenomenon, but at the same time have the free access that we have, as you mentioned earlier. Is that something that is being part and parcel of this strategy actively?
Well, it's not built into the strategy. Certainly, though, we heard during the strategic plan that we did this past year that people want those type of amenities associated with the library.
So I've heard that, too.
So we are looking at those options. Is there some sort of coffee service or that type of beverage service that we can provide in our buildings, or is there other options? The leasing option, of course, to the private sector, it has to be a business case that would be justifiable and validated for them. We do have a coffee service, a private vendor at the Millennium Library, but they have the traffic too, so they, you know, that's part of their business case in justifying that. There may be other opportunities. Henderson Library, a good example, and this is one of the values of being in those leased facilities. They're often in strip mall type situations where there are coffee facilities. So Henderson's a perfect example. There is a Tim Hortons in that very mall. So we wouldn't consider one in the library because of that.
Yeah, you probably have restrictions on that as well in terms of
we need to
the mall.
Take a look at, you know,
the leasing requirement.
If there is four coffee businesses within 100 yards of our location, it would be probably there'd be some pushback from the business community, right? And we've already seen this in some other of our recreational facilities where we were serving patrons and had some not so positive comments from the business community, in as much as they were located within a quarter mile, for example, and felt that service we were offering was impacting their business. So at the same time, we have to be cognizant of that issue.
Yeah, no, it's something that I heard about just even recently with the open house that we had in our community for the Transcona Library but then you'd have to accommodate the square footage, right? You have to put a business case around that. You have to build that into the plan. My last question, Mr. Chairman, thank you, is a number of years ago there was a report, I forget the official name of the report, the unofficial name of the report was the Fielding Report. And the whole concept behind it was to look at co-location. One of the recommendations Scott Fielding made when he was newly elected councillor and he was appointed to this committee to look at efficiencies and whatnot was, is there a way for us to provide library services more efficiently by co-locating libraries with the provincial government with construction of new schools and so on and school libraries that exist already in the community? And you know, it never really got off the ground, but it was an interesting concept, especially now in terms of the growth that we've seen in the city and the demand on the province to open new schools. And they've now moved to this model, as you know, in terms of elementary schools, where they're going to quite a large footprint for these schools to serve more regionally so that they don't have to build as many schools. And so in that sense, it almost creates a greater opportunity for us in light of the fact that they're going to be building bigger schools and probably have bigger library spaces, my guess. And would we or have we looked at this, or is this something that we could consider, you know, especially when it comes to West Kelowna and all the growth that's happened up in the Northeast, knowing that there's demand for facilities and schools, and now in the Southwest, that we could be doing this?
Just a general comment, and then I'll get into some of the details. Absolutely, co-location, sharing resources is something that, from a library perspective, is interesting and a topic that we're pursuing. I will just make one comment. We are not prepared to co-locate an elementary schools, and there are really young children, and as much as that, you know, how you would have, you know, a whole bunch of adults sort of moving into a library system, and how you take care of security and issues, safety issues for our kids. So when we look at that type of initiative, Counselor, which is obviously something that we want to look at also, we look at if we're going to consider something like that, it has to be with a high school setting, not a K to 8 setting.
Actually, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that, and thank you.
Yeah, Councillor,
clarification, and I just want to be clear, I'm not opposed to having better library for all of West and Old Kildonan. Co-location, actually, will part of relocating West K, will there be, like, we talked about owning lots of land. There was a community committee that represented the whole Lord Selkirk, West Kildonan, or pretty well West, all of West Kildonan and Old Kildonan, was chaired by a fellow by the name of Dave Brazier, and they planned out the, it was a cool concept. They built the Maples High School, they built the Maples Community Center, and we built the regional indoor pool, the Seven Oaks Pool. That whole property, it's a huge property. Actually, right, we or the school division owns all that land. Is there any consideration being given to the city building on there a new library? Because kind of the Maples is would be, you know, if you want to be geographically sensitive, there's definitely a hub there, right? You can't deny that there isn't a hub there. Then there's the hockey arena, right? Yeah. So are you going to give any consideration to that? Like, and it is more centrally geographically located.
Well, I guess I can say that, you know, we're not at that point yet. Part of the process...
Well, you said this is West K is going to be a lease, but,
yeah,
but we own a huge amount of land.
We would build in conditions in terms of site conditions and criteria, what we're looking for when we do an EOI. It doesn't mean that somebody couldn't come forward with a proposal that would suggest that as a location. That's our challenge.
So will the city of Winnipeg make that proposal? Or?
I don't know about that.
We'd have to take a step back and evaluate that opportunity,
because
certainly don't want to discount better solutions, right? If they are out there. So okay. We will take a step back and have some conversations around what you have.
Well, I'm just saying that. Like, but I had a question though. When you're going for lease and leasehold, and this is I am concerned about, you know, like, and some of the programs we offer in the library, poor people are definitely using those, right? So, and they're not driving cars necessarily. But when looking at a leasehold improvement, like, if you get two EOIs, and let's say bus service was the demand, right? And you got an EOI from a place that already has bus almost to the door, which is what actually Powers has a the current West K has a bus stop, like, right almost immediately there, stepped across the street, a small residential street. And the building is really close to the right-of-way sidewalk. But in a leasehold, if you got an EOI from one place that has bus service basically to the door versus EOI that, like, I don't know if we put this in the demand, but it'd be very limiting, but versus another mall where its bus service is, like, it's totally inappropriate for persons with disabilities, for sure. To bring a bus into and you're talking about leasehold improvement, that's the building itself, but, like, would you expect an EOI to factor in bringing the bus service to the basically to the door entrance of a strip mall?
Well, I'm not sure we would put it that way, but
because that would be like a million.
In our evaluation, Counselor, those are terms, those are conditions, and that we have to seriously take a look at, because it's not always about price, right? Price is a big piece of the puzzle. But as far as transportation, accessibility, versus if a strip mall where you're walking 10 yards to get in the door versus a major mall you're suggesting where maybe there isn't a transit loop coming into the mall and you're walking 150 yards in winter across a parking lot, absolutely, we will look at all of that, because at the end of the day, serving community, and our community is made up with a whole bunch of segments that whose needs need to be met. That absolutely is a consideration, because people, elderly people, children, people with disabilities, I'm not expecting a 15-minute walk across a parking lot at 35 below, right? So absolutely.
Five-minute walk
right.
across the parking lot
right.
in a wheelchair.
No,
we hear you. Didn't see you.
We hear you.
Thank you, Councillor Eadie.
Thank you,
Councillor Schreier.
Thank you. You mentioned accessibility, obviously, now a big issue for me. I guess my concern is that it just doesn't go to the lowest bidder. Often does it?
Everybody is pretty well aware that price, in any matrix that we use, probably in 100% of the time has the most points assigned to it. But there are a whole variety of other assessments that occur that can mitigate, us taking the best price. So when we're looking about serving community, it's not just about putting a facility on a piece of property or leasing something. It's about accessibility. It's about the facility itself being accessible, being on one floor. It's about customer service points that are accessible for people in wheelchairs and people with other disabilities. All of those accessibility issues are huge from a library services perspective. And the piece that you're talking about, both councillors, I believe, from the transportation, is critical.
As we move forward, things change. We're moving to new territory. You've got to look for a new location. It's new for the administration. Public consultation, I assume, is going to weigh in on this.
As Rick has mentioned before, there's two phases of consultation that will occur. The biggest thing that we count on the public for is letting us know what their expectations are as far as service. Obviously, Rick has been involved in this for many, many years. So a basic program of requirements that we know is happening in libraries across North America, there's sort of a consistency of that. But when you talk about libraries in specific locations, they may be cultural, they may be other types of demands. Outside of that normal type of library service that is reflective of meeting needs in the 21st century. So that's where we listen to the community, and that can impact design that's a little bit different from one library to the next, for example.
Now, you talked about how the new library for the new regional library, inevitably, whenever it's moved, is going to be larger than the current West Kildonan library location. But you also say it's going to be a lease. How do you work out the fact that how big the place is going to be, but you don't know where it's going to be?
The expression of interest, Councillor, will provide all of those answers for us, because in a lot of instances, as you're correct, you may not find 14,000 square feet in a row. But what happens is the landlords will often move tenants, right, into other vacant space to accommodate that 13,000 to 14,000 square feet for us. So in the instance of Henderson, for example, when that was built, there was some relocation, right, and in Charleswood, of existing tenants, right, to accommodate us.
In that case, Henderson Library has been in Rossmere Plaza for decades, generations?
Right, but the recent redevelopment, actually, which did a major expansion, they had to move tenants over to allow our expansion.
Fair enough.
Take up the space of the old police, community police office.
Sorry, Councillor Schreier.
Good question, I must admit. Any comment on that regarding the police station? Not that I would prefer it there, but fair enough.
How does, in terms of owning versus renting, how does that work out with the Cindy Clausen Plex?
Well, Cindy Clausen, as you're aware, we moved the West End branch, which was a very small branch with a lot of the same issues facing Charleswood and other branches, and that was a build, right? That was at the same time we were developing Cindy Clausen, these stars were aligning, right? So that opportunity we took to put an addition, sort of, and it was sort of even later in the game too, right, when we came in. So it was a little bit, but we managed to get ahead of the HVAC and the mechanical systems and did an add-on to Cindy Clausen. And the results of that move, Rick can speak to the numbers, were phenomenal relative to circulation and things like that.
So. And that speaks to Councillor Wyatt's comment about trying to pull amenities together into one location. So libraries with other types of recreational amenities, we know that it benefits them and we know that it benefits us.
So that is, but the city owns that one?
Yes.
The, in terms of renting and owning and coexisting, what do you call it, co-usage, for Southwest, Future Southwest, obviously we're looking at a megaplex there, with including the Y and stuff like that. Would that be owned by the city? Is that the intention?
At this point in time, in speaking to Councillor Wyatt's comments, we would be looking at opportunities for co-location on that site. As you're aware, Pembina Trails has bought a big piece of land in that area, and it's a high school. So if we could partner, that would be great. So we're looking at different options depending on circumstance and who's which stakeholders are currently on a site or preparing to move on to a site.
How about River Heights or the library?
River Heights, we are.
That was in the redevelopment plan too.
Yeah, we are in the process of releasing an RFP imminently relative to looking at a master plan which could possibly contain a whole multitude of components, but the River Heights Library is part of the Strat plan. For those of you that,
right?
For those of you that have been to the River Heights Library, you'll understand why we're recommending the redevelopment, replacement of that branch. It served the community well for a long, long time. But we will be looking at other locations and through an expression of interest, no different than...
Could end up like around Grand Park High School.
It could. Yeah. It could. I mean, there's, like I said, we won't know anything definitively until the proponents have prepared responses.
Right. Thank you, Chair Pachtakam. So we're here today discussing this, coincidentally, because of stars aligning and coincident potential for rotating schedules for libraries. It says here that in the report that in italics from the community services meeting from October 2015, meeting with options and implications of revising the schedule of library development. As if it seems to me maybe that we were here to revise the schedule all in all. But that's not what it, just so you know, I mean, that's not what it said. The resolution here was advancing the date of the new leased library facility within the old Kildonan ward to 2017 from 2021. That's why we're here specifically. You know, events that stars aligning that precipitated that's having this greater discussion is merely coincidental. That's not why we end up here in the first place. So I just want to get back to the original reason we're here. You're offering this proposal, but I guess my question is, we were asking for options and implications of advancing the date to get back to the original, the core of this. Advancing the date of the new leased library facility within the old Kildonan ward from 2017 to 2021. So if it wasn't for the fact that we're in a position now to rotate, to exchange library times, what would you have said in your report in terms of options?
We, well, we if that obviously...
Because I had no idea. No. I had no idea this was coming up.
Well, I mean, the recommendation would have been, subject to council approval, if it's the will of council, advancing, you know, the West Kildonan build or lease has been put on the table. So the options would have been, you can advance it, but there's financial implications, right? Because you're now taking a $1.4 million lease and bumping it up 4 years, so you'd need approximately $1.2 million in additional capital, right, for the lease improvements, right? So that, or the other option would be not to do it, right? So in the absence of the Westwood Library being deferred, the only two options would be, is council prepared to add money, right, up front, or not?
And to be honest with you, I already knew that. At the moment we voted for that, I assumed that. So what your answer to me is no surprise to me, nor anyone. So the question is, I'm surprised by the coincidence that the resolution said 2017. What a coincidence that it happens to coincide. What if it had said 2018? Would we be talking about Councillor Gillingham's
It would just be advancing 2021 to 2018, a decision being made, are we advancing the funds or not? The only reason why, and it's for, obviously, for a political, you know, decision, is that if, in fact, there's a hole in the strategy, right, in 17, there's an opportunity to advance and keep the dollars the same on the capital side. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Fair enough, and I would have known that. In fact, we all would have, I assume. I look back and wonder why it says 2017. Why would it just say advancing it and offer a realistic option to administration as to when this would occur, when you could find an opportunity and
2017 is there only because the fact that the Westwood Library was a placeholder in that year.
No, sir. That's not.
But the reality, we have three libraries left.
Coincidental,
right? We have three libraries left. You can't.
We have River Heights left.
Right, but River Heights is in phase one, right? So in the second phase, those last three libraries left, two were leases, one was a build. So if there was two builds and one lease, we couldn't even make this recommendation because there'd be, unless council wished to, because it would add $4 to $5 million to the overall capital program.
I just wish to advise you that it's not mentioned at all in the whereas clauses. It's not mentioned in the discussion. The option for rotating these things that have nothing to do in terms of the discussion here at this table or the other committee rooms when we move this resolution. So it had nothing to do with it. It had nothing to do with it in terms of anybody told me or anyone that was discussed on record. So just so you know, it had nothing to do with it. Okay.
Councillor Wyatt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Knowing we have this expansion of this our debt policy and knowing how difficult the financial time is in terms of our budget and how reluctant corporate finance is in terms of taking on new debt, and knowing that this is all supported through mill rate support, which by and large, this program is being funded through our debt strategy. Should we be reducing and scaling back the replacement program?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
I mean, in as much as...
So there's no pressure coming back from.
At the end of the day, I mean, from a public service perspective, we presented this strategy is our best... our best professional expertise around how to migrate our library system.
We all have wish lists, right?
So, but the wish—if you're calling it a wish list—council approved that wish list, right?
A few years ago, and we've been hearing messages coming from the chair of finance about the state of the city's finances. There was a budget. There's a public consultation taking place. We've heard all of this stuff. And to take the chair of finance seriously, why is this why is this a sacred cow?
All we're suggesting is that if there's a will political will to do this. It can be accommodated. It's zero capital cost. Your comments are relative to, you know, the chair fighting. I can't speak
to that.
That's
sort of outside. I appreciate that. I know.
I have a question though on that.
No, let me finish. Okay. You've been very patient listening. Anyway, my other question is in terms of provincial funding. The provincial funding right now, the model seems to be very lopsided in terms of funding that is now happening in this province in terms of every other municipality except the city of Winnipeg. There is a formula they have in place, from my understanding, is that it's quite generous or fairer, I guess, maybe is a way to put it, to municipalities other than the city of Winnipeg. It's allowed municipalities outside of Winnipeg to build libraries, which really, you go and see them, they're quite remarkable, you know? I mean, for communities which are quite a bit smaller than our city, our municipality. You know, should we really be building libraries when our provincial funding partners are really not at the table?
I don't know how to respond to that. We do communicate on a pretty regular basis with administratively. Rick has a pretty good relationship with his provincial counterpart. You are correct. The formula is different for Winnipeg than it is for rural Manitoba. We acknowledge that. There's a cap on
the same
our grant,
formula, but it's capped. Yeah.
That I think it's 1.9 and change.
Sorry. They just kind of ignore the amount of people we have in the city. They cap.
I can't comment on that. But yet we meet on a regular basis and push what we feel is a similar agenda. But at the end of the day, those discussions happen politically.
It's just, you know, I mean, it's been something that I know has been raised with the province in the past. I know it's been documented. It's been raised at the political level in writing by previous mayors probably, and it's something which never seems to be addressed. It's almost as if we're second class citizens when it comes to our libraries here in the city of Winnipeg compared to every other community in Manitoba, not just rural Manitoba, but every other community in Manitoba, whether it be a small community, a rural nature like a rural municipality, or a town or city outside of Winnipeg. What makes them? Why should they receive higher level funding for their libraries than the city of Winnipeg citizens?
Once again, those are decisions made by another level of government that I.
It wasn't in the throne speech. There was a lot. Everything else in the throne speech.
I'm not privy to comment on.
But that was not. Every other sink and everything was in there. Yeah, okay, thank you.
There's more announcements to be heard about libraries. Just going.
Okay, cool. Oh, good.
Anyway, I had our leeway.
I forgot my question. Hang on.
Sorry, Councilor Schreier and Councilor
Eady. So I have this. Right on Leela Avenue in Garden City Park, the feel of the Garden City Community Club. Big development. Could you comment on the new development by Bird Construction, I guess? We're talking about co-use, and I'm talking about location, and it's right next to Garden City Shopping Center.
What do you mean, the soccer?
We're talking about a plex that's being developed. Could there be a comment? To be specific, Chipacticann, I'm talking about the potentiality of location of the library.
I can comment specifically on that site. There will no more development going on to that site.
It's full,
right? I mean, we've really sort of gone as far as we can without the community, you know, going, what's going on with their green space?
Yeah.
So
soccer field's gone now.
Do you have another question?
I just wish to make a no further question.
Okay, Councilor Eady?
I just had one question because it's on the table, the strategic plan, but our redevelopment. But when this was developed, there was a conscious decision that the city would not be expending any dollars to establish a new library. The whole plan is we're still going to have, how many is it, 20. So that's cognizant of money and so on. This redevelopment strategy was really acknowledging that we're not going to be building any new, adding any new libraries to the city of Winnipeg system.
The redevelopment strategy simply stated anything that was dealing with existing libraries and the replacement of them. It did put a statement in there that did talk about there could be future development of net new libraries as the community grew and as we pushed out in the city. But that's all it referenced. And
I just only said that.
Yeah, yeah, that's as far as we got with that because the focus of the redevelopment strategy was on existing infrastructure.
Right. Thanks.
Are we voting on this?
With regards to this, these three libraries, the Westfield Dillon, St. James, and the Westwood, in the report, and you said that when you did the review of these three libraries in the original schedule, you did a technical review, you talked about the accessibility, the age, the maintenance costs, and that's how that you came about with that. Were you also considering like future growth of an area?
We look at that. We look at location of the libraries. Are they on main arteries? Are they on high traffic areas? Are they visible? We also look at it from our own lens that would look at our libraries from a functionality perspective. Like, do they have the amenities that people are looking for in public library service today? So those three pieces are all part of it.
And with regards to, you said the public consultation occurs once we land on a schedule. That occurs after you determine the schedule. And then you're talking about what kind of topics are you talking about with the consultation?
It starts, I guess, as the money comes into play through the capital budget. We would hold a pre-tender consultation with the community to find out what are the amenities they are looking for. That would be built into the expression of interest. That's our program of requirements. That basically says to a potential developer, this is what we're looking the library to be. These types of amenities, this size of library, this number of parking stalls, single story, the accessibility issues, it addresses all of that. After that's awarded, of course, we'd hold another consultation to be able to share with the public as we're moving through the stages. This is the design. This is what's being proposed. What are your thoughts? Are there changes we still need to make to that? And that's all factored in as we move into that final stage and then construction after that.
Okay. No other questions for our staff?
Councillor Eady has asked me to hand out. Okay.
So in terms of the process, Madam Clerk, how does that work?
I believe it's an amendment to the Winnipeg Public Service recommendation.
Thanks, guys.
So you would vote on the amendment before you vote on the Winnipeg Public Service recommendation.
Okay. Thank you. Madam Clerk, if you don't mind reading into the record, please.
Councillor Eady is proposing the following motion. Whereas when the Community Services Department Library Service Division created the Library Redevelopment Strategy, there was no community consultations on whether or not the residents wanted to have their libraries moved, and if so, in what year. And whereas the proposed changing of the order of the library replacement within the Library Redevelopment Strategy Report does not consider the West Kildonan Library and Westwood Library communities' preference in changing the order of the redevelopment, therefore be resolved that before item number 2, proposed changing of the order of the library replacement within the library redevelopment strategy, is sent to City Council for consideration, the Winnipeg Public Service come back with a public engagement plan to consult the two communities about whether they believe the priority order for the Westwood and West Kildonan Library should be changed in the library redevelopment strategy.
Thank you very much. So, Councillor Eady, you're moving that?
I'm moving that.
Okay. Would you like to speak to your motion?
I just, all of us as city councillors knock on doors. You can call it a community consultation in a way, but really, this whole redevelopment strategy, nobody really knew about it until, for example, in Charleswood, they started to engage the people in so removing it and so on. But what's happened here, I believe, is we came up with a strategy. I looked at it and I thought it was fair. I used to be on the Winnipeg Public Library Board. been to the Westwood Library, been to the Westwood Library, been to the River Heights Library. I think I visit almost every library. The only one I was even at William Stevenson Library. So what happened is there was a plan put together in consideration, and what we have here is, as the director of community services called it, this is a totally political decision based on what two councillors are saying, and they give this impression that somehow their communities are okay with putting one off later than another one and so on. And I think that when they came up with this strategy, I voted for it because I believe that was the best order to proceed based on all these community needs. What is reflected in the report and what's been explained by our administration, they said, well, all three were there and it was somehow arbitrary. But it wasn't all that arbitrary for the last three libraries in, or whatever libraries in that plan. Really, it was considered on a need. And I think that if we're going to change the priority, we should really consult the two different communities to find out what they think. Because one of the reasons I thought 2021 was okay is, although St. John's Library might get finished by 2017 or whatever, if it is to service a bigger catchment area as a local library, right now it's in no way able to do that. And but anyway, I just think that the public in these two communities should really be consulted before we change priority. Because I'm telling you, my mother-in-law lives in Crestview, in St. Charles. There's a bunch of people there that don't even know anything about this library redevelopment strategy and so on. If they were to find out that somehow we could have had something better to serve their community and serve them, I believe that they would be quite concerned that all of a sudden now this is being put off for, well, from the other counselor's perspective, it could be put off for 5 or 10 or 20 years. He doesn't care, right? So, and he did present that it was a community issue about the arena, and I agree. That was a whole issue about the arena, not about the library, in which he heard a lot about in his campaign. Again, I'm very familiar with the area in terms of friends, family, and so on. So, anyway, I just think there really should be a public engagement to find out if they're okay with putting this thing off when they could have something better sooner.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Wyatt.
Yeah, you know, I'm just reading the motion here. I have an idea for an amendment in terms of what is suggested here.
Would that be a sub-amendment?
I guess so. An amendment to the amendment. And it speaks to the St. John Library matter. I heard Councillor Sharma's comments today, and I think I can understand where the pressures are coming from there in terms of that. The fact she represents an area which is growing, and there's a lot of pressure on that neighborhood in terms of growth. And services or lack thereof in terms of library services that are accessible and modern and close, or not close, but at least in that neighborhood or region. And at the same time, I'm also hearing from Councillor Edie's concerns in terms of the existing library that's there now, that has historically been there. I know these are difficult things. And the reality is, I think the solution is going to be ultimately a solution where, West Kildonan is probably going to be redeveloped and moved. That was the original plan anyway, in terms of the library development strategy. The issue was not necessarily the relocation of West Kildonan. The issue here, from what I can see, is timing. And what I think is interesting, too, is hearing Councillor Dobson's comments. The impression I got from Councillor Dobson was it's not just a question of moving it moving it back, the Westwood Library, the impression I got is it may not need it at all in terms of actually being the redevelopment strategy. Somebody once said that to argue against public consultation is like arguing against motherhood and apple pie. And I don't want to argue against public consultation. I mean, I was one of the, I recall Councillor Packham, when we first arrived here, the big issue of the day was, if you recall, was going to the four-district police model, you know, and the closing down of police stations in Transcona and down Old St. Boniface and amalgamating stations and so on and so forth. And one of the key things that we did at the time was request public consultation citywide in terms of before we enacted that. I mean, we did the consultation, but ultimately we moved down the road of what has so far been a three-district model because we haven't done the final station in that plan. Which is the Hartford station. But, I think ultimately the proposal put forward by the public service here, you could argue whether it be politically driven or not, is one that I think is not a bad proposal. I think it's a solid one. I think it will happen. It's 2017 is not next year. It's 2 years from now. I think we have a bit of time to do some consultation. Maybe that's... But I would like to see in the resolution something to the effect of maybe at the final wording of it, the redevelopment strategy, and in the context of the St. John Library relocation renewal.
What's that?
Well, it says in the report here, in addition, just to answer Councillor Edie's question, he just kind of interjected.
Sure.
No, that's okay. I'm suggesting an amendment because the last, literally, on the page 6 of the administrative report, the last sentence says, in addition, as the current West Kelowna Library is located less than 1.5 kilometers from St. John's Library, relocating the library is more... in a more central northern quadrant will help provide better library coverage for the entire community and could result in increased traffic in the St. John's Library. Now, if you're going to increase traffic in the St. John's Library, you're going to need, you might have to look at issues there in terms of servicing the community. So I would surmise that relocation and renewal of that library may be on the table. And indeed, Mr. Chairman, if Westwood is actually not a priority at all, if it falls off the table, because it's not seen as a priority by the community's happy with Westwood, and in terms of priorities, it can be delayed. Maybe there's an opportunity for St. John's to be developed. And I'm sensitive to the fact that it's an older neighborhood too. Minarski and West Kildonan is one of the, I guess founding parts of Winnipeg, and so. I'm sympathetic and I'm hearing both sides. I'm hearing what I'm hearing from Council Sharma, which I think is a legitimate, reasonable request and a reasonable concern. And I think there's an opportunity, but I'm also hearing from Councilor Edie about his concerns, Councilor Edie's concerns about his ability to service his existing community and the concern that he has that there's maybe something being lost by the relocation. I think, I have a community where we have one library, right? Councillor Edie has a community where right now technically he has two libraries in his ward.
But it's a ward. It's not a...
I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. No, but I mean, it does to a certain extent. But I'm agreeing to the resolution. I just... think it needs to be amended. If Council is prepared to accept the amendment, then I think we can do something.
What's the specific wording?
I said I added and in the context of the St. John's Library, maybe not relocation, but St. John
able
Library.
Able to meet extra demand. Is that what you're
saying? Context of St. John Library
increase in traffic or in the context of the potential increase of traffic at the St. John Library.
I've asked the Rick Walker to come back just on that point because
it is being renovated. No,
my recollection there's something going on.
Councillor Pakatan, it is being renovated. You're adding an elevator to make it accessible. Councillor Pakatan, there's no need for administration to come back. But the renewal of the St. John's Library, the neighborhood itself, remember, hasn't been consulted yet in terms of West K and all that. So to add this on here, he's just saying that we want them to look at whether or not the St. John's Library, after it's renovated, is going to actually be able to pick up the extra traffic that more than likely will happen.
And just, you know, on my motion or amendment, Mr. Chairman, if I could just say that I think this could happen fairly quickly. I don't think this is a long delay. I think you could have two public open houses or two public meetings, one in West Kildonan, one in West, I'm assuming that's where they would take place, Westwood. And you know, I think the timing is good, actually, on the cusp of a provincial election. Maybe we can get the provincial government here more involved in funding our libraries and make that an issue as well. So I'm really happy that this motion is being moved at this time, right before a provincial election campaign, because I think libraries should be at it. Why are libraries outside the city getting a heck of a lot more funding than inside the city? I think the citizens of Winnipeg have a right to know that. Thank you.
Can you just reread your amendment to the amendment?
So, Councillor Wyatt has a friendly amendment to Councillor Edie's motion, and it's simply by adding the following words: and in the context of the potential increase in traffic at the St. John's Library.
So that'll be part of the public engagement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So at the very end of Councillor Edie's motion, we will add the words, and in the context of the potential increase in traffic at the St. John's Library.
Which is exactly the wording of the report. The last sentence.
Thanks. Any other speakers to the motion? Councillor Schreier?
Sure, thank you. I just want to say, when this first came to this committee in its previous incarnation without the name Parks on it and before Councillor Wyatt was a member, my concern was that the original plan, my thinking was that the original plan would bring forth, if it was delayed, not delayed, if it stayed on the same course that all councillors present, except for myself, I believe all voted for, that it would lead to a better decision. We'd have a better plan. We'd have a better library with more time involved. And because it would be probably a 20-year plan, a 20-year lease. So it's a big issue. It's a big deal. Therefore, it would be, in the long term, and every year in that long term, every single year, better, including for Old Kildonan, for the Maples, for the region. And having said that, it looks like there's an opportunity and the will to expedite this, so fine. But that doesn't mean that my concerns are going to be secondary now. In fact, this is an opportunity to sort of bring them to the fore. And on that basis, my concerns are going to be accessibility issues and public consultation. This is what we're in a position to do to make this a better decision. So be it. So on that basis, and Councillor White, his bothered to mention issues about provincial funding for libraries, rural and versus the city, and fine, let the conversation be. I look forward to that. If this can benefit libraries in general for Winnipeg by virtue of this amendment and this, great. Let's make this a better process. Pardon me.
Oh, sorry, nothing.
I don't know how, you know, the fact that we have got a Millennium Library, I don't know how that fits in with other places in the province. But you know what, we're going to learn from this and potentially gain. So it was, by no means was my intention to politicize this, over politicize it, but that's our prerogative. That's the prerogative of council and councilors and these committees. So that's not wrong. So let's go forth. And as long as my concerns are addressed in terms of making the best decision possible, so be it. Public consultation is going to be part of that. I can't say it won't. I'm going to go along with the amendment and the sub-amendment, believing that this is the best chance to achieve the best regional library for the long-term benefit and every year within for Old Kildonan Ward, the Maples, that growing area of our city, and that region of our city. That would be the purpose for supporting this, and I don't see why it won't. There's nothing about it that says it won't. Didn't want to get too political, but this, I believe this can only help. So, in the spirit of Councillor Sharma's initial request, I support this.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Shire. I want to thank everyone for speaking on this, on the sub-amendment as well as the amendment and then to the main clause as well. My thoughts on this, I want to thank Councillor Sharma for sort of initiating this process. She came here to council stating that, she's noticed some growth within her area of the city and she would like to have some consideration relative to the West Kildonan Library. As part of the grand scheme of things, as well as having a library that would, take into consideration the growth that she's witnessing happening in Northwest Winnipeg. So here we are. We had at EPC a motion to ask the administration to come back with some implications and options on those implications relative to, if we were to rejig the schedule from the West Kildonan Library coming up in 2017 and the Westwood Library coming up in 2021. They're saying there's no financial implications. We heard this morning from both councillors in the respective wards regarding these two libraries. Both are in support of the administrative recommendation, councillors. In terms of the call for the public consultation, that's going to occur. We heard from staff here today that it's a technical review that they do with regards to the redevelopment strategy. They take into consideration maintenance costs, location, functionality, amenities, accessibility. All these libraries are old libraries. They need redevelopment. And they've come up with their technical review. They've come up with their recommendations. They're saying that the changing in the order isn't going to have any effect on the applications. At the end of the day, councillors, in a few years, we're going to have three new libraries. That's going to be a huge win for these communities, for the city of Winnipeg. These are going to be modern libraries with lease facilities, it sounds like it, and taking into consideration new technologies. And when that happens, there's going to be consultation relative to the type of technology, the type of accessibility, the location. Councillor Sharma herself, she said she's not interested in getting involved with the location. She just wants to ensure that the development that's taking place is well represented within the library system. So in terms of the actual sub-amendment, while the intentions are good, I'm going to be supporting the main clause I'll call for the vote on the sub-amendment.
Can we just close on the amendment then?
Yeah.
I just wanted to... say, Westwood should get... The community should be... I understand the consultations that will happen when they move. But what's happening is, if one community is being... is going to have to wait longer for better service, which was factored in to this plan. So there has to be some kind of consultation and in perspective of that stuff. So anyway, I just close on something.
Council,
I moved it, so I'm just...
Since we're dealing with a sub-amendment, does...
Sorry, sure. Just a clear response. Sure.
It's a friendly amendment.
If Councillor Eady accepts Councillor Wyatt's friendly amendment, what he is moving is that before making a decision on the recommendation, that there would be public consultation, that... his motion is that proposed changing of the order of the library replacement within the library redevelopment strategy is sent to City Council for consideration, that the Winnipeg Public Service come back with a public engagement plan to consult the two communities about whether they believe the priority order for the Westwood and West Kildonan libraries should be changed in the library redevelopment strategy and in the context of the potential increase in traffic at St. John's Library. So count, that's his motion. You'll vote on that to see if it's approved, carried or not. And depending upon that, if it's not, then we would vote on the Winnipeg Public Service recommendation.
Can I just, I'm sorry for interrupting, could I just say you should actually have their public service come back with a public engagement plan within 60 days?
You can put a time limit.
Sorry,
yeah, that.
That's so, very friendly. 60 okay. days.
Within 60 days.
Yeah.
Because I think is in January, right?
Yeah, sorry, I didn't put the.
Yeah. And Councillor Eady has agreed to that, so his motion is all inclusive now. So
just in terms of whether speakers speaking to that, how does that work?
Well, you can now call the question on that amendment, and then you can call the question on the.
But I noticed Councillor Shire wishes to speak.
A point of order, actually.
Okay. On a point of order, yes. Councillor?
Because it's a friendly amendment, does Councillor Wyatt have an opportunity to close on a sub-amendment?
No.
Okay.
No. It's been approved, and that's what we have in front of us.
Okay. So the question, I'll call the question
on Councillor Eady's motion.
On the Councillor Eady's motion as amended. Is that correct?
Correct.
On the amendment. Yeah, as amended.
As amended.
Yeah.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Record me in opposition.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what Councillor Shire held. Councillor Shire.
Aye. He said aye. Something for a better library.
So it's passed.
Okay.
And you're recorded in opposition. So this matter will not be forwarded to council at this time.
Do we have to vote on the report as amended now?
No, because...
Well, that's right.
The report was to go to council with the swap, and you said no. Let's do public consultation.
Yeah, in terms of this this resolution, where does it go now?
It would go back to the administration.
Okay. Thank you. Item number 3, Recreation Facilities Master Plan Update.
I believe there was a request for a couple-minute break, and also...
Can I run to the washroom?
The director requested that we hear the presentation before.
Oh, yes. Okay.
They're both his items, so if you're willing to do that.
For sure, yes.
I got to run to the washroom. Mm-hmm.
Because it's not on the screen, so you'll have to look up there and type them on it. You'll know as I click or as I choose the connection. Thank you.
Thank you. Efficient.
I'll be right back.
You brought in a pizza last night.
I need lots of caffeine today, sorry.
You're on a roll.
And
there you go.
Are we doing number four?
Three, right?
No. We're going to do number four,
four
first.
And then we're going to do three. Oh. Okay.
Like consideration of Indian Center for Child Protection being here for since 9:30.
Okay.
Right on. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Sounds good.
Set them free, so to speak.
Sounds good. Councillor Schreier.
Okay. We're gonna reconvene. Councillor Schreier is just on his way, so.
All right, so just I just briefly like to make some introductory comments. So what we have the Canadian Centre for Child Protection here today to present sort of a vision about a pilot project that we are entering into with their organization and the City of Winnipeg. The genesis was Councillor Bawadi had asked for us to investigate how to better protect our children and youth in our facilities. We have an organization that this is their mandate vision. Everything that they do is wrapped around serving children and ensuring that wherever they are, they're in a safe environment. So we're going to ask Signe Arneson, the Associate Director, is that
Executive
Associate Director,
yeah.
And Noni Clausen, who is their Marketing Media
Director
of Education, to run through what is being proposed. And then if there's any questions, comments, we're happy to respond both from the public service and from, we call them C3P.
Okay. Well, thank you very much and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Rev.
For having us.
We're very, very excited to be here, so thank you so much. What we're hoping to do today also is to give you a bit of a genesis of the background of who we are, just quickly, and then what was proposed and where we are today to give you a bit of a status update. So as an agency, the Canadian Centre for Child Protection, we are a national charity and we operate cybertip.ca, which is Canada's tip line for reporting the online sexual exploitation of children. And this is actually what gives us a very unique lens into this space around the sexual abuse, sexual exploitation of children. And this would be one of the reasons why Councillor Bawadi was interested in us in working with our agency to get a lens into areas that could be augmented in public facilities to better protect children. So what we've seen to date in our agency is we've had about 161,000 reports to our agency, and 90% of those reports, and those are specifically to the tip line, address child pornography. And so what we see in those are typically prepubescent children, but what we're knowing is this is a growing problem in that technology being misused by those individuals who have a sexual interest in children to either gain content of children, and surreptitiously in public areas is one place in which that is done. So what we've done is we as Councillor Bawadi had tabled in June a motion to be working with our centre. Since that time, we met with Councillor Bawadi and we met with Mayor Bowman, who were very much supportive of this initiative to form a working group with your public service senior level workers to look at this issue together and determine a plan to put forward for what needed to be done to augment safety in the facilities and where we would start. So the goal really is to put together a plan to prevent child victimization within aquatic centers and recreation and leisure facilities and libraries. That was the overall goal when Councillor Bawadi came to us and when we talked to Mayor Bowman. And in that, looking at really two phases, or three phases really, with phase one being to enhance the existing child safety policies that are in place in the Winnipeg public pools, and to develop tools and reporting structures to build staff capacity. So looking internally at the staff
and what is happening within the facilities, as well as externally at looking at resources for patrons who are also frequenting the facilities. What we're really excited about is that Winnipeg will be the leader in this, is that we have not done this with any other jurisdiction across Canada, any other city in Canada, where we've actually looked at how can we mitigate risk from the organization or the facility level to better protect children within public facilities. So we're really excited about that and really applaud the efforts by the City of Winnipeg. In phase two and three, we would then be looking more at leisure facilities as well as libraries is where we would move next. We also have a very unique opportunity to gain and to look at an evaluation of this in sort of a pilot phase for us. It'll be more of a pilot phase because we will use this to move across the country. We are a national organization and we will take what we've learned from Winnipeg and be able to apply that in other jurisdictions. So in looking at the plan, what we've done is we have put together a working group which comprises of the City of Winnipeg Public Service and staff from our agency. We put together a needs assessment and looked at risk within the facilities and discussed that in terms of the operations now. And we are currently putting together a plan to strengthen the existing practices and clarify the procedures, which we'll talk about. And then the goal is to implement the plan in the city run aquatic centers and then eventually in stage two and three, the recreation and leisure centers, and to create resources to build more awareness for patrons around that, looking at ads, posters, brochures in that type of property to be promoting the awareness, as well as some social media and making the public aware of our agency as well if they would like additional information and understanding the area of child protection, and then to evaluate the program. So to date, where we are is we have done a risk assessment in a site visit. We have gone to visit pools. We went to the Pan Am pool, and then we had a consultation around the other facilities, site, looking at the sites, as well as we went to some leisure centers. And we did a risk assessment on the physical environment is what we look at first. And then we look at the policies and procedures and do a review of what exists currently. And then use our lens in terms of our expertise in this area of child safety and what we're seeing happening through the tip line and the organizational culture. We look at those three areas, which we've done. And in the review of our findings, what we found is that there are currently a lot of fantastic policies in place in the public pool facilities. What we can do is we are going to be able to use what exists and augment certain policies with a child protection lens and perspective that we can just add to it. And that includes with staff training. A big part of what we'll be looking at is preparing individuals for also being able to identify risk and looking for high-risk situations and high-risk behavior and being able to identify those behaviors and then being able to action based on those behaviors, which would mean reporting on those situations and then taking action once reports have been made. There's already fantastic policies in place for that that can be used as a structure, as a foundation to build on. We've also found it just incredibly in terms of the cooperativeness and in terms of the collegiality and working with your public service leadership team has just been fantastic. They really have been outstanding in terms of helping us, in terms of working with us and providing the information that we need, and also in the enthusiasm and motivation to really increase the safety within the facilities. So that is basically a status update. When we look at the next steps, what we're going to be looking at is putting together an administrative report that will go to Standing Committee on Protection, which will be on the Protection, Community Services, and Parks by March, is when we're looking at doing that. And then internally, what we'll be looking at doing is augmenting the current administrative procedures and protocols as discussed, but also looking specifically at staff training and how we can build their capacity within the facilities of those that are working in the facilities, and then also externally how we can do that for patrons so that they can be part of the accountability structures as well as part of the solution in terms of providing surveillance and supervision within those facilities to protect children. So an example will be the awareness, the resources, and the reporting protocols for internal staff as well as for externally for patrons. And that is pretty much it in terms of a report.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for the presentation.
You're very welcome.
We appreciate the work that's occurring. Any questions of the delegation? Councillor Schreier?
Thank you. So according to the statistic analysts process approximately 3,000 to 4,000 reports per month. That's nationwide?
That's right. Yeah, correct.
And it says total reports received 161,000 plus. So that's throughout
Canada.
Canada in a year?
No. Those are reports that we've taken in since inception.
Yeah, we're getting about 36 to 40,000 reports a year now.
Yeah.
But keep in mind the tip line started as a pilot here in Manitoba back in 2002. Yeah. We kicked off. We were then officially launched as the national tip line in January 2005. And from that date onward, where we've had more money to be raising the public's awareness across the country about the service, the reports have just gone up exponentially.
Okay. So that's total reports received since its inception
that's
in 2005.
Correct.
And it started in Manitoba. So, I mean, I was going to do an average here if the national reports per month is approximately 3,000 to 4,000. That ends up being around for Winnipeg, around three a day. If I was to base it on a national average, I don't know what to say. I don't need to do that because you'd have statistics specifically for Manitoba.
Mm-hmm. We have for Manitoba. Yeah. You can report anonymously to us, but we do know based on GOIP what jurisdiction you're coming from.
So that's what I'm just getting by an average. It comes down to breaking it down, three a day in Winnipeg. I don't know. That's what I kind of see. But because these are anonymous tips, it's sort of difficult. It's a difficult job for you in terms of assessing.
Well, what happens with the reports that we take in, because of the jurisdictional issues with the internet, right, what's important to understand is that because a report comes in from a Manitoban doesn't mean that it falls within our jurisdiction within Manitoba or within Winnipeg to address that concern. So we have analysts there who are trained to be taking in and triaging the reports for law enforcement across Canada, and they triage those reports, and if it's potentially illegal in terms of the types of reports we take in, those reports are forwarded to the jurisdiction who would have the authority to reside over determining whether or not an investigation would ensue.
I think the reason we're talking about the tip line, just to provide context back to what the initiative we're doing here, is that every single day we are intersecting with a community who has a sexual interest in children. We're getting those reports, we're going to the forum boards, we're looking at the Boy Love community, we're seeing the commentary. We never could have anticipated years ago how technology would be introduced and used within facilities where children are drawn to, where naturally then adults who have a sexual interest in children go to. So the reason the tip line is so relevant in the context of this discussion is because we have an incredible lens into that community and how they try to access mm-hmm. and harm children.
Which really helps us with when we conduct risk assessments, right? Because then we can be looking and we use the information we learn from all the chat logs that come into us with individuals who have the sexual mm-hmm. interest and the like-mindedness in which they're communicating to inform where risk lies. And then when we're going in and doing those scans and looking at the behaviors and things, we can provide a role in risk reduction.
Thank you for the question. Councillor Eadie?
I think this is great work you're doing.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm asking a question only because there's a whole, like, where these recreation centers, pools, and so on and so forth, the assessments are good, and many of these, many of our kids, the youth, are near schools and like our rec centers. And, is there, and you're getting the tip lines, and there could be some kind of harassment of a particular child, and it may be on the way there. I'm not sure what kind of things are coming in, but have you in the past interacted with like a blocked parent kind of organization or whatever in terms of like some kids could be more susceptible than, like.
Well, just to clarify, the tip line relates to the online sexual exploitation of children,
right.
So it has to be people taking their offline activity,
yeah,
and moving it online. What we know is that those who have a sexual interest in children inevitably can't help themselves because it's a need-driven behavior. They inevitably photograph these children, and it becomes a currency that they utilize online and trade amongst the pedophile community. To gain access to more material, so on and so forth. But it's through that mechanism that we really intersect with it when it moves online. But what we do see in the online side, which obviously is terribly troubling, is the conversations around where are you, if you've got an interest in children, going to gain access to kids, because that's your level of interest. So. Back to what Noni was saying earlier, we commend the City of Winnipeg for being so incredibly progressive around putting something in place to try and strengthen these things, knowing that your average citizen has no idea how this darker side of humanity operates, or the way they seamlessly move through our communities. And these types of facilities are areas, you know, that unfortunately attract those individuals. So that's how it kind of all connects together.
Mm-hmm. And again, this is something that we're seeing everywhere. This is a worldwide sort of issue we're seeing because of the issue of technology and the popularity of technology, but also the incredible progressiveness of the devices in terms of what the capabilities of the electronic devices are now. So it's really, for the City of Winnipeg, what's exciting is that it really is progressive in terms of trying to get ahead of it and mitigate risk where it's possible, because we know that it's a real concern and a real risk.
So these pedophiles now, if I'm using a device,
mm-hmm,
and I've got my Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, and I've got location services turned on, these pedophiles can actually know where these youth are located at any.
Well, more so what they're doing is if you have a sexual interest in children, you have to gain access, right? You need access to children. And so what they typically are doing are communicating with one another. So there's what we have online are communities of pedophiles who can get together and chat. And so they get together and they talk to each other, and what we see them talking about is where are good places to go to either for voyeuristic services or for loitering services, or for loitering purposes in order to meet their sexual needs and gratification. And often what they're talking about are opportunities at pools. They often talk about pools, and it's probably one of the most popular spots. Yeah, and leisure facilities, public community facilities, but pools are a hot spot in terms of what they communicate and changing opportunities.
Beaches,
right?
Areas.
And so even when we go in and we talk about the risk side of it and we look at the physical environment, part of that too is doing, again, just the sweeps of the physical environment to be aware of that these devices may exist or may be planted or put somewhere, and just being aware of that, right? And that can go a long way to just in itself mitigating potential problems. Yeah.
Thanks. That's great.
One thing from our perspective is that when you have an educational campaign and with brochures and signage and things like that, that alone, if you walk into a facility and you see that sign, for example, sitting right there, you know people are watching and paying attention to what goes on in our facilities. That's critical for us.
It's an enormous deterrence. What you're saying to everyone is that people are paying attention, they're trained. You're never going to prevent this type of activity, but you certainly can mitigate and reduce. And these type of efforts go an incredibly long way because it needs to be easy. They want it to be easy. If it's not going to be easy, they go somewhere else where it's going to be easy. So these steps are imperative.
Yeah. And the public plays such a critical role in terms of surveillance, right? In the public being aware. And then them, because they are offering so much supervision within those contexts of the public facilities. So by bringing them in and making them knowing and aware, it's also very helpful to have policies and procedures in place that are clearly communicated and transparent, that everybody are following. It also creates an external inhibitor for those who are looking for access. Yeah.
What can citizens do to protect children from, you know, from these folks? Being sexual victimized.
Well, you know, what we're really promoting in this type of context is that people becoming more aware of what would present as high-risk behavior, what would be concerning behavior, unusual behavior that should be not only just noticed, like most people notice it, well, that seems kind of odd, but knowing what to do with that then. So not only just, you know, noticing themselves, but making the facilities aware so that they can also be part of solving the problem and making the individual know they've been noticed and also reestablishing the expectation of the standard of behavior that's expected within the facilities. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, grooming is a huge aspect of this, right? If somebody sees a child being sexually assaulted or abused, we know what to do.
Yeah.
But when you're observing inappropriate behavior, what we want citizens to do, both within the facilities and the public, to say, that's odd, I need to escalate this, and those concerns need to be addressed. It might not meet the threshold most of the time for illegal conduct, but you're possibly preventing it from getting there because you're more aware of what you're observing and that what you're observing isn't okay.
Yeah. And that in itself actually ends up preventing a lot because just in someone noting that they've been noticed and someone's going in to correct their behavior can, again, stop it right there from escalating.
Excellent. Any other questions?
Nope. Very good.
Good.
Amazing.
Great initiative. You guys really should be very proud.
Yeah.
We're so excited about the leadership from the city.
Good job, Clive.
Yes. There's a lot more people than me that are driving this, but a lot of effort through multiple departments. And like we've said, in my opinion, after phase three, there's a whole bunch of other phases that we're going to be looking at, just where public are coming in and interacting in our own facilities. For example, here, wherever we have washroom facilities. Right. Wherever you're bringing in kids, wherever you're in lineups or whatever, so.
But I do have to say,
the partnership.
But their leadership team is just exceptional. Like, it's been so fantastic to work with them, and the work that they're doing is really, we can't say enough about how outstanding it is. And this is really just going to be to augment and provide a very unique lens that's new to everybody. New to everybody.
So that makes sense.
Thank you for that feedback.
So I should probably just go home.
No, you retired on this note. Is this
going to be the extended retirement?
That's right.
No.
5 o'clock is retirement party.
No.
I'm not letting you go.
No.
Really excited to be working with the center.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
Looking forward to the next steps. Thank you.
Thanks, great. Thank you.
Okay, if we can get Councilor White, do you want to move it as information?
Absolutely.
All those in favor, all those carried. Our last agenda item is item number 3, Rec Facility Master Plan Update.
Let me just take a minute. Corporate communication, I'll tell you, these guys. Corporate communication, the stuff they put out, like, it just blows my mind.
What is this?
The stuff, they're just... they're drafting press releases in life from the area, but they pick and choose issues. Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Who's the new head of corporate code? Got a point every
time. Okay, Mr. Whiteman and or Mr. DeGraff, I don't know who's coming up. We're on item number 3, which is the rec facilities master plan update?
So we were being requested, I believe, to provide a verbal update. So what I can tell you is conceptually, obviously, and based on really the inordinate amount of project proposals that are sort of coming from community, the public service and my department believes that support for a recreation master plan will be critical in order to provide council with you know, information in order to decide A, B, C, D, right, when you have similar projects, which ones should we be doing and how. So, but the reality is that there, that plan will not start until the budget process is finished, right? So we are waiting just to see how that works relative to the 2016 budget. That's as far as much as information as I have, but for those of you that were around, and I believe with the exception of Councillor Schreier, everybody may have been here for the public use facilities report. So that report's about 10 years ago, looked at a contemporary mix of recreation facilities that would service our whole community, and looked at... No, that was received as information, I believe, that report, because it was pretty significant. But really what we're trying to do is just provide for council, hopefully, an opportunity to consider a whole bunch of variables that are attached to a multitude of proposals. I'm sitting on probably, and I won't get into naming any of them, but there's at least 20 proposals right now that I've heard over the last 2 to 3 years that the community's interest in. It's critical to identify and stage, obviously, what we can and can't do with the resources we have while looking at existing infrastructure. So we look forward to moving down that road if the opportunity is provided to us.
Thank you very much,
Bob.
Okay. Questions?
Councillor Schreier?
Now, what process will not start until after the budget?
Well, I mean, when I take a look back at the cost of the previous study, which was fairly comprehensive, there was financial resources required to deliver that, obviously.
So this is going to be the recreational facilities master plan update. Is that what you're talking about? Will not be done until after the budget?
Oh, absolutely. We won't start that process until the budget is dealt with in 16.
Yeah, because there hasn't been a disposition from any committee of council for us to prepare a facilities master plan. It's just a departmental strategic plan that we would like to do.
So I'm part of my overall departmental plan. This is part of...
Okay, but wait. Okay, sorry. Go ahead, Jason.
No, go ahead. Sure. Like something's written on your mind.
I'm confused because I understood Councillor Yee mentioned to me that there was a briefing of this committee of this master plan about a few months ago.
We actually support it.
Oh, no, I understand that.
It's not just a department-driven thing.
I appreciate that.
We're totally promoting it.
Well, what the heck are we promoting if there's nothing happening?
Well, no, we're not saying there's nothing happening. I mean, but
you're just saying there's no direction given, so you're not doing it.
No, what we're saying is that we've asked for resources, right, in order to deliver it, right? And we don't have those resources in our 15 budget, so we've asked for resources in the 2016 budget.
So how is it that we have resources to jumpstart and get, we got $350,000, $260,000 of which was redirected to do planning for development, not anything to do with recreational service development. How is it that Southwest Winnipeg is able to jump the queue and get everything moving and yet we can't seem to get a citywide funding for a citywide recreational facilities master plan? How does that happen? That only happened on a Wednesday.
Well,
2 days ago.
We
went to council.
The dialogue had begun over 3 years, 4 years ago, in understanding what was coming and how fast it was coming in South Winnipeg, right? So conversations with the stakeholders have been occurring, acknowledging that that magnitude of a build, which we do have large pieces of development, but nothing that large.
So acknowledging that when you're talking about, I believe it was 10,000 units in Waverly West, accelerating probably 50% faster than we had thought the build-out was going to happen, that pushed that demand up. That demand is irrespective of a master plan exists, right? Because it just does because of the volume of people that have moved into those neighborhoods.
I'm the only consistent person on the committee. I'm the only consistent person on this committee. I want to say that Clive, and you can answer this. At the same time we were talking about grant, this is for the 2014 budget, at the same time we were discussing grants for the Y to build recreation facilities in the southwest, east, northeast, and northwest areas, which are, we all know, are not being filled. In the context of that budget discussion, at the same time on our agenda was this whole master recreation plan. So how did we not get funding to put this master plan together in, you know, like, so it wasn't just 2015, we're talking back to 2014 at this particular moment, that I as a committee and we as a committee talked about the master recreation plan.
So let me just sort of try to sort of compare apples to apples. In the Grant Park Recreation Master Plan, right, in the consultation that will be occurring in South Winnipeg, that is sort of similar to feasibility studies and consultation that's happening outside of our builds with a whole host of community organizations, right? So we are, and this is, I'm just going to sort of my own philosophy relative to everything has to come into a funnel, right? But you need to sort of do background work, right? The Grant Park plan, right? We need to do a whole bunch of work around what that's going to look like in a feasibility perspective. No different than all of our community organizations are spending money, right, up front from a feasibility perspective to develop business cases, right? When there's a rationale for business cases, that we talk about multiplexes, for example, business case development from revenue streams supporting loan guarantees. And then we have other proposals that are more gym orientated and smaller in scope that typically we don't ask for equity positions in. So, but all of them are spending money, right, to justify in their minds that based on public consultation, talking to community, what they see their community need is results in new infrastructure asks, right? Those then get put into the context of really when you have competitive proposals, which we are finding that we are getting in regions and even smaller community areas, right? I'm not worried about the neighborhood piece because it's dealing with a neighborhood and a small catchment area, but those bigger ones, there's competition. So they're all doing feasibility work up front, preparing information for consideration by the city and other funding partners to see whether there's support for them. So all of this, right, has to be considered in the context citywide. I can tell sometimes it's easier in some respects to look upstream to see that demand is coming. Waverly West is an example. When Rick talked about the library piece this morning and Ridgewood South, that's acknowledging that something's coming. Where we really need to make the more difficult decisions is relative to, let's call them more developed communities that have been around for a longer time, right? And infrastructure, they're looking at replacing and or improving infrastructure. So there's the big developments, which will require something, we know that, without doing any assessment, we know that inherently, because that's sort of how we build out based on policy direction, like the active policy framework, the recreation, leisure, and library facilities policy frameworks. That sort of guides us, right, as far as when you see incremental growth of X, it drives Y. Right? So the idea, or the thought is that
we would then take not just community infrastructure asks, but all infrastructure asks. But they have to come with some background work done on them for us to even understand what the scope and the staging and what the dollars might be. So when we talk about Grant Park, there'll be perhaps there's multiple stakeholders, Grant Park Rec Plan. There could be some phasing. We know that we're looking to relocate the River Heights Library, right? Is that site the best spot for it or attached to the Pan Am? We don't know, right? But that will come out of that that master plan sort of, when I talk about the site master plan, not the citywide plan.
This is very confusing.
So, but at the end of the day, we just want, when these proposals are coming in, we want to be able to provide you with public service recommendation at the end of the day based on real work behind the scenes, demographic, community need, what's there, what's not there, what's the demand, what's in the, being hosted in the not-for-profit or private sector, all of that information so that you can make a decision at the end of the day, whatever that might be, but we're going to give you good information that will result in some tough decisions when you have competing, obviously, projects. In, you may have a ward that has two or three projects, right, that are all looking at similar types of expansion. You may have, you know, one in one ward butting up against another in another ward, right? So we would be making suggestions to you that, you know, perhaps only one of these projects should be coming out.
Okay, but we have to somehow, Clive, depoliticize what is becoming extremely politicized. Let me give you some examples. Let me give you some examples. Southwest Winnipeg jumping the queue with the report that went to council last week. A pool, which is under construction in my ward, that has literally stopped with the nothing happening on it because of a funding issue. Another pool that I hear is now $2 million of a budget in Seven Oaks. And that report has to come forward and is being held back. I have a... You want direction in terms of direct public council giving public service direction in terms of requesting a directive? I have it right here, a motion moved by myself, seconded by the mayor. On May 6th at EPC of this year, the Executive Policy Committee concurred in the council motion of April 29, 2015 and recommended to council, number one, that the Winnipeg Public Service be directed to conclude the Memorandum of Understanding with the YMYWCA with respect to the three model expansion partnership with 180 days. Number two, that the proper officers of the city be authorized to do all things necessary to implement the four. That was a month ago, that deadline. So now, you know, this 180 days has passed. There was nothing at council saying we needed more extension of time on this. It's almost as if the public service just took this, threw it in the garbage. Is that how motions of council are being treated by the public service?
I'm going to say no, because...
Well, because that's what's happened to it. It's in the garbage. It's nowhere. Where's the follow-up to this? What? That, to me, I'm assuming, is not your fault. I'm assuming this is political interference by the mayor and the mayor's office.
I have no comment relative to...
Who else would stop it other than the mayor, who has the power to do so, and the CAO? I'm saying we need a recreational facilities master plan, obviously, in the city to depoliticize what's going on across the city, which is moving limited resources, which we have as a city, at the expense of some neighborhoods to the benefit of others, without knowing fully exactly how. I mean, that's why we had Unicity, I thought. I thought we had Unicity because we wanted to treat all the neighborhoods equally and fairly. And we're now back to pre-Unicity. We're back to, you know, which is the stronger guy at the table, pounding the table. I know that game. I played it. I know it really well. But I thought this election and the new mayor and the new council was supposed to be all about a new way of doing business. Seems like the old way of doing business is exactly the way that's being done right now. Anyway, you know what? I'm just frustrated. Now, what do we do? I move a motion, it's ignored. You're telling me there's nothing happening here? There is something, but there's not. What do we got to do to get stuff happening in the city where we can ensure that the recreational facilities of the city, the demand in the future that we're getting,
you know, right now, we're, you know, you mentioned Southwest Winnipeg. Yeah, we're behind the eight ball now. But that's only because we don't have a master plan for the whole city, knowing exactly how it's going to unfold. And we don't have a master plan, I think, partly because we haven't been used to this growth and partly because we don't know how to fund it. And I think that's why the why issue got so bogged down, is it was on the funding. And we throw that up as an immediate reason why we don't do anything. But, you know, that's not an excuse. We have to figure out ways to pay for these things. And I have now asked two councillors in this committee and at the last committee, would you be prepared to have service charges, area charges on your area to pay for new growth, to pay for these new facilities? And both the councillors avoided the question. One today and one last earlier this month. Lukes and Sharma. Both avoided refusing to answer. Well, you know, you can't have it both ways, guys. I'm prepared to move area charges on new growth in my area to pay for these things. If I need to pay for a Y or whatever it ends up being, right, a rec facility, I'm prepared to do that. But so do those other councillors. But they don't give a shit. They just want their cake and eat it too. They just want the money out of the general purse. So how do we address this growing problem? And it's not just a problem of building new facilities. It's a problem of the older facilities that we have that are running down, that you know, and here we are, we're building new facilities, and we can't even fix a pool that's 50 years old. You know, I mean, I'm looking forward. I've got a sign that's already been designed that's going up on the Transcona pool. This pool closed thanks to the mayor of the city of Winnipeg. Call Brian Bowman. Because that's what it's going to be. 2 years in a row, that pool's now outdoor pool closed. And, you know, but nobody seems to give a shit. Excuse the frankness here, but, you know, like it's really unfortunate because all these rec facilities are aging. We got older pools and we have no plan. And I've been hearing about this recreational facilities master plan for a long time, which is why I put it on the agenda. I'm glad you're here to talk to it. But we have to somehow bring it to a head. And, you know, what do we need for resources to do this? You know, a few years ago, I headed up the Rapid Transit Task Force. That was a $200,000 project. Mike, you were part of it. Angela was Gervasi, and we had an advisory committee. Maybe we got to do something like that. Maybe we need a citywide consultation process that will take us across the city, hear all the issues, because I think there's issues with regards to the new facilities, there's issues with regards to our old facilities, there's issues with regards to lack of programming dollars in existing facilities.
That is a big piece of anything that we will do, will be massive engagement in the community committee areas, right, to solicit community input into what their priorities are. And you mentioned existing infrastructure versus shiny new penny, right? I mean, those are questions that have to be asked. And it has to be asked also in the context of dollars and support for, you know, the resources that are required in order to make those either improvements to existing amenities where required, because the new, you know, or do existing amenities, does the facility condition index suggest that it makes more sense to rebuild one than to renovate one? All of those conversations, and we want to take direction from the community, but the community will tell us, we know that they want a lot, but in the context of that conversation, it has to be guided by principles of financial impact.
But I can tell you right now that I can name one project that I know is going to have we follow an agenda when it comes to financial responsibility, which you're talking about, when it's convenient for us. But when it's not, we throw it out the window. And I'll give you an example. I mean,
who's we?
I'm saying the royal we. And so we're not pointing any fingers. I'll give you an example. Actually, it's in your end of town, Councilor Eady. The Garden City, the new arena.
Indoor soccer?
No, the arena complex.
Oh, the sheets ice.
I'm going to be watching the progress of that business plan and their ability to pay off their loan guarantee very closely. Because if they think that they're going to come back and ask for more money,
from us to increase their subsidy because they can't make their payments when they were the ones who rolled the dice and said, we can do it. Well, no, you guys. You know, it doesn't work like that. You don't bully your way in just to get a bigger facility and then come back knowing you're going to get the money anyway because your numbers aren't real and aren't going to work. No, you're like Southdale now. You're going to send every parent a surcharge on their registration, and you can thank the local community for doing it to you. Now, that's what's going on in the city. It's happening across the city, and but yet there's other groups in the city where are saying we want to be financially responsible. You know, we close down an arena in Transkillina and open up a new one, right? I was at the North End Recreational Center on Friday last week, and I saw it, and I was quite impressed. I mean, it was a busy hub, a busy place. You know, there's a huge demand for facilities like that across the city, but they're not being fulfilled, right? You know, you have an old pool there, the Centennial Pool, where we built this new facility on the side of it. Mm-hmm. Like, we've done a lot of good things as a city, but it seems we kind of do it in spurts, and then we stop. And we have to bring it, we have to have a plan. So what is it going to cost us to do this? Like, you know, is it $100,000, $200,000, $300,000?
Well, I can only tell you what it cost us, because I do know what it cost us approximately for the previous plan. Mm-hmm.
Right? Answer that question on the cost, but what would the terms of reference be again?
Well, we'd be looking at
the master plan.
The master plan would be looking at existing infrastructure, right, and the needs relative to maintaining those pieces of infrastructure. They'd be looking at areas of growth where we don't have infrastructure, and then you have to juggle those priorities. We're looking at the change in demand relative to the types of services we provide in amenities. Right, there's a huge growth in certain sports that we didn't see 15, 20 years ago that we need to acknowledge and accommodate in future planning. Other sports are starting to see declines. So where our focus is, based on that public consultation, not just with community, but with sport organizations and other service providers, will sort of hopefully reinforce what we know and provide additional information to make better decisions about, for example, I use pickleball as an example, right?
I was going to say that.
Yeah, 5 years ago, I didn't even know what that was. Today, I'm looking forward to playing it, which is, you know.
They were playing it at the North End.
Which is interesting, right? Because we're putting down, I never would have thought we'd be, you know, slapping lines down in every piece of concrete that we could find that had a tennis court because you could accommodate it. And that's one example, you know, a small example and easy enough for us to manage, right, because it's paint in most instances, right, because we're using existing hard surface. But when we see explosion in basketball, we see explosion in soccer, the sports that we're really seeing are being driven by immigration and by what the multicultural mosaic that we sort of have in this community, right? So as our populations grow, right, these different sports are growing along with them. And cost of sport. Certain sports have very limited upfront expenditures for families, right? Right? Soccer. I mean, you need a pair of runners. Right? Basketball. You know.
Kids already got runners.
Right? So these are, we have to sort of take a look at, you know, our communities and what their demands are. We talk about, you know, we've had a lot of conversations, for example, about cricket, right, and things like that that are, you know, that are sort of moving forward too. We need to sort of understand what sports are moving forward, what starts moving backward. We have a huge organization just down the street that is heavily involved and has all kinds of research available for us to consider, and we want to hear from the communities and what they think is important. We use water as an example. Our water in the city of Winnipeg is not leisure water, right? It's lanes. We have a few amenities that we've been fortunate enough to incorporate into some existing indoor water. But generally speaking, our water, what we can provide with that type of water amenity is not what sort of excites families, right? So acknowledging that. So we have to sort of incorporate all of that into the terms of reference, right? Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right. I will tell you, because it's not a surprise, because it was received as information, the public use facility strategy had a net present value investment of about $600 million. If we were going to blow this city up, and you mentioned Unicity, right? When Unicity was created, there wasn't a strategic plan to equalize service amongst over-serviced and under-serviced neighborhoods, right? We just sort of moved along with those pieces. That's why we see, you know, a distribution of assets. It seems there's significant numbers of an asset here and no numbers anywhere else, right? This came from town of, city of, previous mayors and councils, right? And right now we're sort of looking at, okay, so here's the inventory of what we have. What's the demand? And then bringing forward, obviously, financial context into that dialogue for you, because as you said, Councillor Wyatt, the amount of, I mean, there's going to be a lot of resources, financial resources, and we need to be very careful about not just looking at new development, right, but also in consideration of existing infrastructure in older communities.
Well, the whole concept behind the why and doing the whys was the idea that we would not have to be on the hook for the operating costs, that we would be involved on a capital cost program with them, and even that would be shared to try to minimize. And that was the whole idea that I had behind the whys, and it was a regional type facility. Mm-hmm. But you know, I can tell you right now, like the system is really, really broken. And I say that on the basis of this. We have this organization called GCWCC. Are they involved with our community centers actively in terms of planning, in terms of dealing, helping them with their issues? Not a thing. Some cases, yes, and some no. Which is really bizarre, considering that we created this organization to assist us. And yet I'm still getting the calls from the community centers about their local issues and problems that, you know, that the GCWCC doesn't seem to be able to handle or doesn't have the resources or the ability.
Like the hockey rink at Rock Rock Community Center.
Whatever the issues are. And they can be small issues, they can be issues. We have issues around programming. We know we have programming, we have facilities that at times we have pools that are sitting empty, and they're sitting empty because we cut the funding for programming 20 plus years ago. We've never had, so here we are, we're running out and potentially building brand new facilities, okay, or expanding facilities, but we don't even have the programming in the existing facility in the first place. So we spent, I don't know how much money we've spent on asset management as a city. Hundreds of thousands of dollars doing an exercise on asset management. And the core of the whole asset management philosophy was to determine level of service, LOS. What is the public's level of service? What does the public expect? And what can we practically deliver and say, this is what it's going to cost to deliver that level of service, and this is what it's going to cost to deliver this level of service? And are you prepared to pay for it? That is the whole idea behind developing. And, you know, maybe we have to do it region by region of the city. Maybe this is the only way it's going to work, because it hasn't been working on a citywide basis. As you mentioned there was Puff and then there was Ralph. I forget the order. Maybe I got it backwards. You know, and now we've got, we're talking recreation mastermind. We've done so many plans, right? But we've actually, in terms of actually following and implementing, it hasn't happened. Now, the library one was simpler, I think. Maybe because it was more isolated. It was just library.
We have subsets of a master plan already at play, you're correct.
Right.
We have a library plan. We have an arena plan.
We have the arena plan in a way.
But is it working, that plan?
Well, I would suggest based on our first two builds, it's been super successful. I mean,
well,
when you take a few.
We'll wait and see if they make their payments. Both of them.
Well, I don't want to, you know, make any comment relative to that, but I can only say that to date, no loan guarantee has ever been defaulted on. So
no,
I expect that to continue. We do an evaluation departmentally and corporately of these business cases, and I will tell you that as a CPA, I'm very conservative when I take a look at these evaluations, and I really want to leave room for unforeseen circumstances operationally, so that we're not, if a nickel becomes an issue, it shuts down a payment. So I hear your concern. These are two projects. Yes, we will have the time before consideration would be given to the next arena redevelopment to make sure that your concerns are obviously addressed, because, you know that you're in the town. That's not a concern for you, though, right? You're not concerned that Transconi's then.
I'm not sure yet.
As long as the city of Winnipeg keeps holding up them from being able to sell sponsorships and everything, because we don't have a sponsorship agreement in place, they can't meet their business plan obligations. I don't understand. That's a real concern. I mean, they have that concern. We have a concern where the locks on the building actually can't, the dressing rooms can't be locked, because there was a screw up in the of how that was, and nobody wants to talk about that because there's a dozen other arenas in the city that if we sent the fire department into, we wouldn't be able to lock the dressing rooms either, and who knows how much that's going to cost us to fix, right? So to answer your question about East End, I don't know.
All I can tell you is that in conversations with our partners at East End, the outstanding issues, and correct me if I'm wrong,
we have been resolving them.
Yeah, they've been resolving them. We've been knocking them off, and we're down to, I believe, only one that Don is interested in. So.
Well, he's satisfied with the progress that's being made on the other ones.
I think, but sponsorship, do we have a legal agreement there? We're told that we have to have an agreement.
No, but we have a sponsorship policy. The council's adopted that all sponsorship has to come and be approved at the floor of council.
I know, but that's
so cumbersome. They're responsible for paying the bill.
But that's the policy.
How does that work,
a policy construct I work in, right? Is that sponsorship? I can't say much.
We could have easily delegated authority there too as part of these projects to say to the community clubs, look at, you know what, you're responsible getting the sponsorship. You guys got to meet your payment plans, and we want to empower you. So get going on sponsorship, right? Don't keep coming back to us. I just, I'd like to referring to the budget process is, the recreational facility. My view is I had a motion moved by the mayor, seconded by myself, and that motion's gone absolutely nowhere.
Let me just comment on that. I can tell you.
Don't comment on it unless there's something prepared to put it in writing.
I can.
This is on record.
There you go. Yeah.
Okay. Recording. All right.
I can tell you that the memorandum, is sitting in the right place right now and is being signed off as we speak. So, from a public service perspective, that memorandum of understanding or framework plan, whatever we're calling that document that you referred to earlier, you will be seeing that.
We requested a memorandum of understanding. Now it's being called a framework. What is it, a framework or a memorandum of understanding? If it's being called a framework, it depends. I'm going to be asking who's running the city, council or the public service? Or is the mayor changing the rules as we go along here, quietly?
Behind the scenes.
No, I really want to know. I'm really concerned. How is it that there's no report back to council within 180 days?
So in a perfect world, you would have seen, a disposition saying that somebody's coming back to ask for an extension.
Yeah.
Right? So that will be addressed.
Well, maybe in a perfect world, it would be addressed in the condo
law. Or was it PPD?
The second ideal would be that... a request for extension. I have a pertinent question, just to interject a bit. So, Mr. Wright.
Oh, this is a...
So,
this is with the wine.
You have appropriately identified
an
individual to help put together this master. So you've already found resources within your...
No, I haven't.
Well, I have an ID.
Peter DeGraff and Knott.
No.
Undertaking, as was said the last time we got a verbal report on the master records.
We are running the Grant Park piece.
I thought he was working on the overall.
No, he's working on.
I thought he was introduced as overall.
No. Peter is preparing the RFP for the Grant Park master plan.
Only the Grant Park.
Right.
So I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah.
So you have a good idea what the terms of reference are. The financial stuff should be too. If you're going to decommission a waiting pool, what are you offering them somewhere else? And that costs money, but you can.
No.
Well, no, that's part of the evaluation.
Because of what you're
you're saying.
But yeah, I won't be recommending those.
No. But I think it's a no. But
you've been to that dance,
Mr. White. Mr. White. There is a proper way to do it, and an inappropriate way to do it. What was being proposed was an inappropriate methodology in trying to move ahead with dealing with financial woes as they relate to existing recreation facilities. In a master plan, there has to be a better methodology developed to deal with.
Absolutely correct.
Okay,
and this is an opportunity.
Because a couple of, like the proposal, for example, in my ward that was there, I think there is a potential to decommission one of those wading pools once certain other assets that we have nearby are renovated and made to the point that it's going to serve what the community expects out of a wading pool or out of a spray pack, right? Some of the other ones, well, you know, every neighborhood has its circumstances, right? And ability to do different things. So there has to be a better way of looking at how to do it. It's not that that it was a mistake to consider them, but it's the methodology that was used that, you know, So my concern is, and I really had hope in this master recreation plan to come up with better. I thought we were moving along that line. So, Clive, what can we at this committee do, Mr. Wade?
Maybe before
to help you,
Councilor Eady, is it okay if we take a 5-minute recess and then? And then we can come back.
Do you want 5 or 10?
No, just five.
Five.
I've got to get out of it. Got another commitment right away. Actually, I'm going to be late for it, but
yeah. Well, then we can just accept the verbal report.
Let's No. Take a 5-minute recess before we do anything with this.
It was my line of questioning, Chair, if you recall, that we interrupted.
Okay, sorry.
It's all good.
Okay. I was going to wear five glasses to see what I look like for you all.
Oh, okay. Oh, there, try them on there, David. There you go. You're going to look just like me, my friend. You know what? You
want to see
more? Give us a couple more days.
You should actually go and sit in my office one day.
This is a joke, and I'll have a meeting. And
the staff may not even know it's me.
We couldn't call a mini me. It would be more like.
And all of a sudden, my staff are doing all kinds of things I'm not aware of because I was away for one day. But Councillor Schreier's been
running the department,
running the department out of my office.
Well, look at the guys.
Everything would be going Elmwood.
Did you see through
all programming?
I can see through. Rather not, but
yeah.
That's a little bit.
Yeah, there is. Yeah.
Okay, Madam Clerk.
Yes, sir. Look the same.
Weird. All right, here, Councillor is here anyway, so good.
Councillor? No, you're right.
No more cameras?
No more cameras while we're in camera.
Yep.
Okay.
Just.
Okay, Councillor Edie. Councillor.
Pardon me, Chairperson.
That's okay.
I want to move, Mr. Chairman, that the matter be laid over to our next regular meeting or to a special meeting at the call of the chair to give us time for consideration in terms of where we need to go forward here. Maybe we can look at developing in the meantime the terms of reference and a plan that could be considered by the committee. We'll work together on it and maybe throw some ideas together and then take some, to get from there, Mr. Chairman. That's a thought.
Great.
So,
is that okay, Trey?
Yes. Any other speakers to the motion?
Point of order.
Yeah.
I know you can turn back to Ken. I was in the middle of my question, just beginning my questioning, and then I yielded to the passion of the moment, and which is fine with me, totally. It's just that also now we're in a motion, and I did not get a chance to ask a few questions.
I apologize to you, I'm sorry for that.
I understand timelines today. If you're in a rush, I understand.
What we're going to do is we can lay it over, and we can deal with the item. And then this way
not another kick of the cat.
We can develop more terms, like solid terms of references, and
are you okay with a special meeting, Chairperson?
Yep, I'm open to that.
We'll buy each other Christmas gifts.
At the very least, before
December 23rd, because I'm gone to Mexico.
But knowing our good luck, the administration is going to schedule the meeting for these members on Christmas or something. That's the way it's going to be. And yesterday,
it's okay.
All right. Good. Everyone's okay with
motion? Yes.
Okay.
Call the question.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you.
Before we do that, I just quickly, Mr. Chairman, I wanted to move this to be forwarded to the administration. I don't want anything back formally. This is a letter of communication from actually one of my community committee or my community club leaders, Mr. Nesby. What occurred, and I'm sorry, Councillor, I'll just quickly read it. It's a letter from him, and this is just him speaking. He's not speaking on behalf of the community club, but what he said is, we had an issue last year with regards to programming, and since we are now the protection,
community services,
protection,
parks.
Thank you,
and parks,
thank you. This is very pertinent. This is under the jurisdiction of this committee because this is dealing with parks.
Why would I suspend the rules first?
Oh, yes. Okay.
I move to suspend the rules to hear
I'll be very quick.
Or why it's
thank you. What's happening is this. Our community clubs get field allocations, but their field allocations somehow last year went offside. And they did not, as you'll see from the letter here, they're dealing with Mr. Honey. They didn't get the allocations that they were expecting. Some of the fields that they got allocated were actually now being ripped up to build a parking lot that didn't exist anymore because of that expense. So things are getting missed in the inventory. And on top of that, there's real restrictions on how our community clubs operate in terms of their areas. And yet there's community clubs who are not using fields. And other community clubs can't access them, even though they've talked to those community clubs and say, yeah, we'd like to use those fields, but because of our system of booking fields, it's really screwed up.
Blanket booking,
and also just
fields where, you know, like as he stated here, he said, we applied for some fields outside of our area in Oxford Heights, and we're told that we couldn't have them because they were not in our area, even though Oxford Heights didn't need them. Of course, how does the city know that? Before we found out about this unavailability of the fields, we applied for assisted maintenance for the fields through GCWCC and received it, even though they weren't their fields. So they're getting money from GCWCC, so there's a real disconnect between GCWCC, between our booking, between what's happening out on the ground. Plus, even without that, there was a delay in them. If you jump ahead, you'll see that they needed to get stuff back in time to start, so the soccer conveners and everything. And this is the time of year. The reason I'm raising it now, this is the time when they start sending the stuff into the city, saying these are the fields
right,
we want.
Getting ready for the spring.
And they need to know, you know, they like to know by March, ideally, or worst case, April. They weren't hearing back until May. By then, the season's already begun. And they're scrambling. Their soccer conveners are ticked off, and they're calling me, and they're upset. So I asked Tom to put something in writing. He did the best he could, and he sent this to me.
We'll certainly take a look at that, and Mr. DeGraff, I see. I'm hearing him writing furiously behind
me. There you go. And I know he's...
Yeah, there he is. Okay. Yeah. So we'll bring these conversations back, because it is a coordinated effort between Parks and Open Spaces, in as much as they're in charge of the fields, but they utilize our booking service, and rather than having two separate booking services to make the booking. So we'll get some people together and have that conversation. Blanket booking, this has been an issue for many, many, many years. There's nothing more frustrating, obviously, you know, when you have a bunch of organizations that are driving by and say, well, wait a second, like, we could have been on that field and there's nobody there, right?
Well, and that's why I'm raising it. And I'm raising it because we have a new committee now. I think it's a serious committee. I'm not too sure, though, whether the you guys take it quite seriously. But we've had two meetings now, and the director of property development has not been in the room. And
the director of public works would be in the room.
Oh, yeah, the director of public works has not been in the room.
I mean, but Parks and Open Spaces, Mr. Domke was here this morning.
Then he left.
Because his issue was more around the naming.
Right, the first report.
You know, if
the
he was,
parks.
Right, but.
The recreational facilities is not his issue?
Well, you see, it's sort of a combination. On the naming, it's PP&D Public Works that really.
But you have plant. Planning, parks, and everything else is under P&D. Park planning is under P&D.
Yeah, we've got maintenance and operations.
Maintenance, operations,
and
public works.
Planning. Right. And not all planning, because there's planning, obviously, that occurs as part of operations and maintenance. But development, urban development, and that you have a unit in public works.
But Clive,
so you're right. When you talk about parks,
yeah.
You know, I'm going to correct myself and agree with you, because I would agree that it's in a lot of instances, PP&D will be involved.
We need the directors here at our meetings. Like, they have to. I'm not going to put it in a motion. I'm just communicating it. Okay. The directors have to start showing up here, or else we will put it.
Well,
in
there
a
are
going to
be implications on decisions on hard infrastructure, like vertical infrastructure, that will impact horizontal green space.
Or right? I have to conclude that the mayor's decision to rename it this was just for political reasons and for branding and to take advantage of a political press release.
Because of why, I will definitely
take it
under advisement.
Thank you. Are you out of order?
Councillor White, your motion is to simply forward the communication to the Winnipeg Public Service?
Yeah, just to pass it along and kindly request that they pursue
Please
the matter.
Figure out how to deal with it. Yep.
Thank you.
Well, that's... Yeah, we've heard that from a lot of...
Thank you, Councillor Shire. Can you consent to the adjournment?
No. With all due respect, Chair Pactican, I just have a... Just a... I had some questions for the director. That's the thing, eh? We're talking, which is fine with me. This is a good meeting, as far as I'm concerned. So we got time constraints, so we got to go. What is horizontal green space?
Well, I'm just talking about...
vertical green space?
It's just, you know, you have a living wall in a library, which is vertical, that's vertical green space.
Okay.
But no, we're just talking about the parks and open spaces. Our big, you know, when we have a parcel of land, it's not just... You know, the hard building infrastructure. There is green space.
Question.
Yeah. Okay. So perhaps
Councillor Schreier is listening to every word you're saying.
So, lucky it came up. Lucky I was at Freshie the other day and saw a green wall, although it was plastic. So,
Justice and I move adjournment. Okay. Consent agenda and adjournment.
Good meeting, Mr. Chair.
Carried.
Thank you.
Pardon me. Okay, return. All right.
You're going to return the glasses, you're saying?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, not Micah.
Ooh. Ross, you missed out. I put on five glasses, and it,
did you?
We could trade places.
Hey, I'm pretty sure. Oh,
across the courtyard here.
I'm sure that I'll go, one day somebody will tell me I've made a whole bunch of decisions.